The Board of Selectmen for Wednesday, April 5th, to order. And before we get to our business, I have two presentations to make. These are certificates of appreciation to our two outgoing members of the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Atherton.
Should I hand just hand it over to Bob?
No, I get this. I just want to thank you for your public service to our community, and hope you continue to come join us as guests, and welcome to hear from both of you if you have a comment.
You might be nervous what we'll say. We'll have
no, absolutely not.
There'll be a little more freedom when you're on the other side of the table sometimes. So there you go. Fair warning.
If you'll indulge me for 30 seconds, Jim, I sat up here for 6 years, and I'm privileged to have served the voters of the town of Nantucket. Nice. But I want to take a moment to recognize Rick, because 9 years on the Board of Selectmen, yeah. And that, a lot of years on the FinCom, what, 1983, you said?
1993.
93. That's a lot of years of public service, and 6 years for me seemed like a long time, and I thought it was time for me to step down. So hats off to you.
Bobby, it's been a pleasure to work with you, because you're refreshing, and you always tell it as you see it, and that's a real virtue for everybody. So.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
If Sabarino's applauding, we're really in for some trouble.
Mr. Chairman, I beg your indulgence.
Oh, uh-oh.
I was going to wait until public comment, but I just came in from TV land, where I have been for 9 years, watching these board meetings, and wanted to recognize the fact that it is both Rick and Bobby's last session this evening, and tried to come up with some way of recognizing it, which is not as formal as a certificate, but maybe something that would lend a little levity to the proceedings. Mm. And as we all know, when we were growing up, when we had our special day, we always got to wear a crown and bring cookies for the class.
I'll take the cookies.
So that sent me to the archives. And I found in the archives a Hooked on DaCosta crown and a Pick Rick crown. Can you believe it?
No. You must have searched, long and hard
for
that.
And they have to wear this the whole night?
Yes.
Is that the rule?
Well, we need it. Well, we should get a picture.
It's the right color, Rick.
All right. Yeah, you get blue. All right. Great.
There you go.
That's awesome.
It does have a sign.
And out in TV land, it seems to us that they're beginning to look alike. I don't know if it is to anyone else.
Bobby's catching up with
so
me.
So everyone
with
knows, I didn't get punched in the face this week on my last week. I actually went to the dermatologist, and she gave me a Dermapeel, so I'm looking like I got beat up. But
And I reminded Bobby, at one town meeting maybe 7 years ago, I was down front, totally scabbed over with a similar treatment.
Yeah, so it beats the alternative. Yeah.
Bobby, don't take your crown off. Okay, so you've got your crown, and here are cookies for the class. With thanks to Selectman Fee, who was up early this morning baking his very delicious chocolate chip cookies, but no one can have any until after the meeting is over.
So make it quick, right?
This also reminds me, Deanne, of one night at a board meeting, maybe before Bobby joined the board. My birthday was on a board meeting night, and a friend of mine who just showed up tonight came to the meeting with, what was it, donuts or...
Cupcakes for the class.
And the glasses.
And in the glasses with candles on them.
Oh, no.
And we did put them on and wore them not through the whole meeting.
No. And I want you to know we have captured you two. the town clerk has helped me, and Erica's helped. So if this is on the front page of the Inky tomorrow.
You know,
so thank you. I'm going home to TV land where I've been to watch you all.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
That's 20 minutes away. You might miss all the action.
We may be adjourned for them. We're gonna get those cookies.
Someone reminded me this is a small fraternity, Selectmen in Nantucket, and I feel like in my 6 years, I was very privileged to serve with some distinct members, Whitey Willauer, who I'll miss, and Mr. Kopko and Bruce, and Patty. It was an interesting roller coaster, and I wouldn't have traded it for the world. And I look forward to watching whoever the new members are next week. And giving them a little cattle prod poke every now and then. And I'm sure that I won't be too far away from the front row, just on the other side of the desk now.
Bobby, they're good sentiments. I share them all. Watching at home is going to be interesting. You sort of throw popcorn or something at the TV or darts, right, as it may be. But it has been an interesting long time. I look forward to other ways to serve the community from out there in some way. So I don't think either of us are going away.
As you all know, my passion for the waterfront and water quality, and I'm not going to go away. So, despite what the rumors are around the island, I'm not leaving forever.
You're not moving to Stowe?
I may take a winter sabbatical. You know, if I'm going to be cold, I want to be cold where I can ski. But I will be back in the summers for sure, or more the majority of the year. So
great. Thank you both.
Thank you. Thanks, Jim.
I have one change on the board acceptance of the agenda. I have one change. The Nantucket Center for Elder Affairs has asked that that they've withdrawn their request to lease a portion of the Saltmarsh Center. And with that change, is there a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved. Sure.
Second?
Okay.
All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Libby, announcements?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This meeting is being audio and video recorded. We have an ongoing announcement. I'm sure everybody now knows that we have a water main replacement project going on in the Prospect Street area involving...
Really?
It's hard to mess. Prospect Street, Atlantic Ave, Milk Street, Vesper Lane, Joy Street, and Mount Vernon, and that will continue for the next several weeks. And lastly, I do... two quick more things. The new sewer department office will open at the treatment plant on Monday, April 10th, and that office will handle all sewer permitting processes going forward, as well as scheduling for all sewer inspections, maintenance, and service requests. All of this information, contact information, is on the website, but after appointing Mr. David Gray late in 2016, he's been working hard to set up a real office out at the treatment plant, and it is getting set up. And lastly, I'd like to introduce our new DPW director, Rob McNeil, who started on Monday, and he's been very busy doing a lot of different things.
You get the memo.
Good evening. I did get the memo. I appreciate that.
We look forward to it every Wednesday night.
So, Rob McNeil, new director. It's an honor and privilege to serve the community and the island here. So, it's been interesting 3 days so far. Fantastic staff and all the people I've met so far have been very supportive. Very much looking forward to jumping in and getting involved.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Welcome. Anything else, Libby?
That's it.
No? Is there any public? I know there's at least one individual who's got public comment tonight. Did you want to come forward? She stepped out. Oh, yes. You're right there. I'm sorry.
Hi.
Just introduce yourself.
Hi. I'm Annie Mendelson. I have a brief statement concerning the service, the public service of a certain area downtown. The downtown Stop and Shop parking area is an excellent design that combines form and function. It is both a park with parking. This area is pleasant and accessible for people making the transition between the waterfront and the town. The quality of design includes use of brick, granite, and Belgian block. These materials define car spots, walkways, and tree planting areas. There are 47 established shade trees in this area that provide an attractive, cool canopy on hot summer days. I hope you will encourage a plan and the owners to conserve this area and recognize the public benefit it provides to residents and visitors.
Thank you, Annie. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anyone else like to come before us tonight on a matter that's not on tonight's agenda? Is there any new business to come before us tonight? The next item is approval of minutes, warrants, and pending contract. You've had a chance to review, I hope, the minutes for April 16th, 2014, and March 15th. Any comments, additions, deletions from anyone?
No, I think the one addition I gave. Okay, thank you.
Okay, with that, I will ask for a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
The approval of payroll warrants and treasury warrants are approved without objection. And Libby, we've got a couple of pending contracts.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have an amendment to a professional services agreement for PLUS with Vanessa Hagen Bruslin. This adds $18,250 to a current engineering contract, which is $93,800 for a total of $112,000. And this is for additional engineering services required during the in-town bike path project. This is a state-funded project, except for the engineering services are not funded by the state. And we have prior year warrant articles to accommodate that amendment. We also have a professional services agreement for DPW with TNT Roofing, $16,400. And this is for repairs to the salt shed roof. The salt shed roof was damaged during a storm on March 14th, and we do have some funding available for it.
Bobby.
Can you remind me again when we replaced that roof?
We replaced it within the last 5 years.
And who did it?
I can.
Because if I remember correctly, we paid over $100,000 to replace a roof that's roughly 20 by 30.
I'm just on
my way out the door. I'm going to throw this dart. It was ridiculous how much money we paid to replace that roof, and it's ridiculous what we're paying to repair it. And I know that we have to pay prevailing wages and all that, but it's not that big a building, and this is a lot of money. Twice in 5 years.
Okay. We have talked internally quite a bit about this because there was an initial reaction very similar to that. And the roof job that was done initially did not have, the appropriation did not have enough funding evidently to do things like repair joists and rafters and other structural components to the roof. So it
is that what this is doing, or is this just throwing more shingles on top of a bad roof? Can someone tell me?
I hate
to throw you under the fire. I'm not going quietly. I'm sorry.
Not a problem. So, obviously, very appropriate questions. Right now, my understanding of the project is that this is being handled through insurance claim, that some damage was sustained because of, as the town manager mentioned, the previous work that was done was into some old... the trusses that were there, there was some
nails didn't hold.
Original, so there was some of that. The insurance claim has been, we've gone back to them indicating that part of that work needed to be shored up, let's say. There's some sistering going on to provide some good hold for the new material going down. But I believe this material, I believe the work itself is being handled through an insurance claim, that okay. It's not going to be to the cost of the town.
I just want to throw this out there in general, not to this building, but into all our town buildings going forward. When we do these kind of projects and we bid these things out, and believe me, I'm pretty sure if you go back through the minutes, you'll see that I made some comments about how much money we were spending for a roof on a building that isn't insulated or anything. But the roofers or whoever's doing the work, we need to have someone, and I'm not pointing fingers at the DPW project or buildings. I'm pointing fingers at all the buildings, whether they're school or town building or whatever. Somebody needs to look at these things and say, just don't throw a roof on a bad on a bad roof.
Sure.
Because we're putting new shingles on. We need to look at it, and if we need to stop and take a breath and say we need another 40,000 or 50,000 or 100,000 to make it right so that the roof sticks. I mean, the roof's been on my house for 25 years. There's no reason a roof should last 5 years and we're repairing it, other than we made a Band-Aid patch to something that needed to be worked farther. And I'm not pointing fingers at anyone here. I'm just saying going forward, and we've come a long way from when we did this roof. Believe me, I know where we were at then and what we had for people to look at facilities and all this. So it just I just want to throw this out there. Going forward, we need to look at the big picture. And it's not always, yeah, there's water coming in, but maybe there's other things that need to be repaired too besides just the outer layer. I sure. just want to throw that out there.
This is a 30-something-year-old facility, that the shed itself.
Right, so. But the roof was replaced within the last 5 years.
Sure.
It was a lot of money. It was $100,000 to do that roof. I remember the bid. And it's not that big a building. And if we needed to replace boards and rafters, then we should have looked at it then. And if we had to come back and find more money, we should have been able, we should have done it.
Understood.
I just another $18,000 just seems a lot of money to me for something that's not that big of a building.
Again, I believe that that money is being reimbursed through the insurance.
That would be great. I hope that's the case.
And yeah. on top of that, those concerns that led to this incident have been addressed and identified so that it's being repaired properly this time.
No, it doesn't
I think
say
Bobby's comments are good advice.
In source of the funding, absolutely. It says it doesn't say insurance reimbursement. If it had, I probably wouldn't even have brought this up.
Okay.
But it says, you know.
But Bobby, it's a good lesson. No matter what the source right. of the money is, you always want to be sure you do a project that's done correctly. I mean, I think that's your real message.
Yeah, you know, and I understand the situations. I mean, you know, this is a building that has to be watertight. If you get water dripping on salt, the salt goes away, and then we're in trouble. But it's just a general comment. It's not specifically pointed at this, and I'm not pointing fingers at anyone. I just wanted to bring, I wanted to air this before, you know, going forward so that, and I believe that all the departments are on the same page here. I think we've come a long way from 6 years ago when I first came on this board to this point, and but I just wanted to reiterate it one more time that it's Thank important you. To look at the whole picture, not just the outer layer.
Makes me reminds me of the night we had the guys doing the school come in. And I said, how come, you know, you're building a school for 40 years or 50 years? You know, our school, we had schools that were 200 years old. What's the difference? Oh, if you want that, you have to have stainless steel nails. Well, that would be another $1 million. I'm like, how could it be $1 million to change the nail? Like, we would spec different.
A 5-pound box in stainless steel nails is now $90, but you know, it's just point, yeah. I look at. I'm thinking back to the Island Home, for example, long. Matt. You know, yeah. where we're at with the Island Home and the maintenance. You know, I think that, you know, from where the town was 20 years ago to where the town is now, we're past that point. But and we're doing a lot of catch up. But I just when I see something like this that I know happened. Within the 6 years that I was here, I have to ask questions about
it. But if you're going to build a building to last 100 years. You know, build it with the right nails. Build it to last. I mean, that's sort of
like this building. This building will last a long time. You know, this building was built right. And
point taken. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments on the pending contracts? Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. We have one item under consent agenda. A gift acceptance for Salt Marsh Center. Libby, you want to give us some information about that?
We have a few gifts here for Salt Marsh. $25 from Betty and Gardner McDonald. $100 from Jane and Scott Stearns in memory of Butch McLeod. And $50 from Carol Crocker in honor of Nancy Swain. So we thank them all very much for their donations.
Thank you. Libby's citizen departmental request.
Bartlett Tree has a, see here?
Didn't we have this last same
yeah.
request
I
a think year this ago? Is
yeah. Multiple yeah. years, yeah, because they need to start early.
And they've got a schedule to do these, so I'd entertain a motion to
so
approve.
Moved.
Is there a second? Any discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. And the next two are also?
Motion to approve both.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Next, Libby.
The Director of Public Health was asked to come and give an overview of some recently enacted Board of Health regulations pertaining to well testing. He's got a brief overview, I believe.
So as Roberto's setting up, I've had a request on a couple of these items, agenda items, for people from the audience who may wish to speak or make a comment. What we're going to do is do that at the end of the presentation so we don't have an interruption. And I'll be happy to get comments at that time. So, Roberto, I'd like to go ahead.
Just in a similar vein, if the board has questions or comments.
I think they should ask them as we go along.
Thank you.
Okay. So at the last Board of Health meeting for this last month, we passed regulations 51 and 78 in preparation for the future of our water quality efforts in Mattaquette. So let me just go ahead and begin on the next, on the first slide here. So based on the original estuaries report, we found that septic effluent, landfill leachate, fertilizer runoff, stormwater runoff, and a few other issues here are the major nitrogen nutrient loading sections of Mattaquette. And all of this nitrogen goes in, goes into our groundwater, goes into our ponds, goes into our harbor. It's just for the background of the people who haven't really been seeing.
Rick, go ahead.
Just a comment on the slide, because this looks to me like the same information we've had for many years.
Yes, this is just...
And let me just... Yeah. I think there are... The support for the landfill portion would be interesting for everybody to understand the backup, where that specific information came from to determine it's responsible for 24%, would be, I think, helpful. And it's helpful in the context, Roberto, that we're talking about a whole new protocol to help determine a lot of what's going on in Mattaquette, including the flows from the landfill and how they affect Long Pond and Mattaquette. So I just think one of the first steps in that process is to validate the information in back of this number.
Okay. So as always, we have to work with the information we have at hand. The information we have at hand supports this documentation. Over the past few years, we've done both the Massachusetts Estuaries Report, which is the source of this.
I'm just asking that the estuary support has to be backed up by something. You don't just read it in their report. And I think it would be helpful to the town and future boards to specifically understand that support.
Absolutely.
You don't have to answer it right now, but in the future.
Absolutely. We can continue rehashing the same information. It's just, this is taken from a previous presentation that we've given many times. So as we know, this is, as the information we have it, this is the nitrogen loading contribution to the groundwater in Mattaquette, as well as across the island. We do know that there is a larger portion that is not shown in this graph, which is atmospheric deposition and other sources of nitrogen. Those are not considered controllable nitrogen. So this is the watershed nitrogen contribution for both Nantucket Harbor as well as Mattaquette that we can control as we know it right now. So, in fall of 2015, when I first started here, we passed the Regulation 64, which requires IA systems in the Nantucket Harbor watershed at all property transfers, repairs, renovations, whole nine yards. Yes, Bobby?
Is that both Mattaquette and the harbor?
No, the fall 2015 was just Nantucket Harbor watershed. So we did not pass a regulation for Mattaquette because we were pending a
sewer
vote. So in spring 2016, we did the SHMO project, which when we first passed the Regulation 64, SHMO and Mattaquette were being considered at the same time. Mattaquette was removed from the annual town meeting article, and we did just the SHMO sewer project in the annual town meeting. Come fall, we did the special town meeting vote with the Mattaquette sewer article. It passed town meeting, but then it got defeated at the ballot vote. So then we moved into the Plan B discussions that we have been having for a significant amount of time. Plan B discussions were Next steps for watershed protection. Is there IA? Can we do IA components? Can we do tight tank components? Can we do water potential and water control to make sure that water isn't being recycled with nutrients in it, in order, therefore compounding nutrients in the groundwater? So we got back to the drawing board. We started researching, seeing where we can move forward. So right now in this winter, we went back, the staff went back and just started researching these next steps. So we put forward Regulation 51, which Regulation 51 is a regulation that has already been on the books, was put on the books, I believe, in 2006 or 2007, which already limited Nantucket nitrogen loading to one bedroom per 10,000 square feet, created the separation to 6 feet separation to groundwater, and we required IA systems upon hydraulic failure. And then we were also requiring a Band-Aid repairs upon technical failures with the ACO in anticipation for sewer. Since this sewer situation is on hold right now, we felt it prudent to go forward with the regulation that you see before you in your packet that will require the same things of the IAs upon renovation, new construction, repair, or property transfer. But the Board of Health, in order to make sure that we're not putting people in a bad situation where they install an IA and then if sewer comes in front of them, they're going to have an IA now, we decided to hold back this amendment to the regulation until July 1st of 2019. So this regulation is in abeyance right now, allowing for 2 years to see if sewer will be voted in. If sewer gets voted in, the amendments are null and void. Is there any questions on Regulation 51 right now? All right. So we also put forward Regulation 78. The original intention of Regulation 78 was to see if we can connect people to the town water. That was definitely not well received. However, what brought forth that regulation, it seemed like people didn't necessarily understand why we were bringing forth this regulation, so I wanted to make sure we cleared it up here. The state of Massachusetts sets a maximum contaminant level for potable drinking water. I've been getting emails and phone calls, murmurs that Nantucket might have high cancer rates. Is the landfill affecting groundwater? Is pesticides and herbicides getting into our groundwater and other sorts of things like that? So I decided to start auditing the files that we have regarding potable drinking water. In a random audit of our files, we pulled about 150 files. Only 78 of those files had water well testing reports in them. And of those 78, the average water well testing report was 13 years old. Yes, Bob?
Are you talking about testing every well in Nantucket?
Yes, sir.
So let's talk about that a little
sure.
bit.
Sure.
So you're talking about Nantucket. All of a sudden now...
This is the whole island.
No, but... So not everyone has the ability to get town water. So
understood.
Why are we testing wells that don't have any other option?
There are options to repair the wells.
No, there aren't other options. I can see testing in Nantucket where you've got town water running through and you've got issues with salt and salinity. I can't see testing every... First of all... Who's going to monitor these things? Are you going to... How many wells are there on Nantucket? 10,000? 15,000? There's a lot.
I'm in the process of figuring out the numbers.
Who's going to take all these reports? And then who's going to pay for them? You know, I get it in the harbor watersheds. I get it in the pond watersheds. But I don't get it in an area where someone has a well and they're never going to have town water run in front of their house. So now you're going to require them to get a test, whatever the cost of it is. I don't know what that is. I mean, I did mine when I first moved into my house 20 years ago. I'm in the same friggin' watershed as the wells in where I live.
Wires Valley.
I live in that well field. I don't understand why we're going to test people's wells who don't have an option to go to town water. I get it in Mattaquette, where you've got solidity, you've got shallow vein of fresh water, and then you go into salt. I mean, there's 45 or 50 people on Smith's Point that would love the water company to run water out there, because right now they're calling Gibby to get water from him once a week and pump it into their tanks. But I don't get it. And in Hummock Pond, the same thing. They run water out there, and there are bad wells. And you know, you're within X amount of distance of the pond and the ocean. You're in. I just don't understand why we got to have every person on Nantucket all of a sudden now come in and test their wells. It's just another regulation, another requirement, another expense that we're forcing people to do, and another piece of paperwork that you have to monitor, which you barely have time to monitor what you have to monitor now. We're going to need a whole other person in the department to monitor 15,000 wells. I mean, explain to me why we need to do it when we're, for 30 years or 40 years or 50 years, we haven't done it.
Oh, there's so many different reasons. But the reasoning you're arguing right now about just because it's been 30 years, what else has changed in 30 years? 30 years ago, we were letting gasoline. So things change.
If I put a Purifex filter on my water thing, whatever those things are that takes all the impurities out, am I good now? I mean, well, why don't I just do that without having to have you test it and make me give you a report and charge me $200 for this and that? I know the town's going to tell me there's going to be some fee for me to monitor my water now. You're not going to do this for free. We never do anything for free in this town. So I'm going to have to get the test. I'm going to have to send it off. I'm going to have to get the bottle. The bottle costs money. I got to send it off. I got to get it tested. Then you're going to take it, and you're going to monitor it, and you're going to tell me, oh, I need to do it every year or every 5 years or every 3 years or whatever. I don't understand why we need to do this. I just don't.
Understood. And if that's definitely your opinion,
but
that is definitely
your
opinion.
But it's not our call. It's the Board of Health's call.
It is actually
a state
law.
You're telling us we have to do it.
This 310 CMR 22 is actually a state law for potable drinking water, and we are forced to enforce it. So what we're doing is setting up a local way of auditing it to make sure that it is enforced.
Is it a state law that every well be checked?
It is not. That's what we're putting in as our local regulation.
You said it was a state law.
That potable drinking water meet the Massachusetts maximum contaminant levels, 310 CMR 22.
So there's a lot between the state law and what you're saying we need.
There's a lot of different paths to meeting a law than having it. So,
this is a part of a discussion. I think, I sit on the Board of Health, so there's no misunderstanding. We have a chairman who is Malcolm McNabb and five members of that committee who have all been through some of these similar discussions. And mm-hmm. I think one of the reasons to bring it here is that the wider source of information is important to get out into the community. Not everybody attends a Board of Health meeting or watches the video on demand. A lot more people do pay attention to Board of Selectmen meetings. So I think this is a healthy discussion. Mm-hmm. People may disagree.
Of course.
But that's part of what we have to deal with. Yeah. So.
There will always be people who agree, and there will always be people who disagree. The reason that I put forth this regulation to the Board of Health for its consideration in a public hearing, two to be exact, was because in the 78 water well reports that we pulled, 80% of all the water wells had an exceedance of the Massachusetts contaminant level, maximum contaminant level. Of those, 41...
So what do you do then? I mean, what are you going to tell these people if their wells are contaminated? What are they contaminated with? Is it salt? Is it...
It can be salt. It can be corrosivity. It can be iron. It can be lead. Yeah, it can be nitrates.
So
they can be altered.
But if they don't have town water running in front of their house, what's their options?
Their options are everything from a carbon filtration system, a reverse osmosis system, kinetic systems.
Can you mandatorily make them do it?
We can require them to bring their potable water to potable water drinking standards. Okay, moving on.
I thought you were going to be at that meeting when you and I were in Vermont.
It's just one,
that's
it's
all
one
right.
more thing, Big Brother, just telling you what you got to do and where you got to do it. You know, I mean, continue, Rob.
Okay. The board. We held two Board of Health public hearings, one in February and one in March. There was a good amount of people there at the February meeting, they expressed concerns, so we went back and we addressed the concerns that were brought up at that first public hearing.
But so, just to be clear, the main contention at the first hearing was the requirement to hook up to town water if it's in front of your lot.
Yes.
Right. Just so we could. Yes. It's very different from what we're doing now.
Yes. The main contention with that was if the water well did not pass, but they wanted to keep their well rather than connect to town water, why would they be forced to connect to town water? So we definitely added the section that requires the water well testing, and they can fix it among their own means. Everything along the lines from getting iron removal systems, reverse osmosis, carbon filtration, anything that we just mentioned.
So I'm a little confused. So the requirement to, what I hear you say is the requirement to test the wells was to identify, and was there's a linkage between people who have water running in front of their house and the testing of the wells.
The original intention of the regulation was for the people who had water running in front of it.
So what I'm hearing from Bobby is, if that's the case, then I can understand it. You know, people have an option. They can either fix it or they can hook into town water. But the concept, it's still from listening to Bobby that if people don't have an option, so
people have options to repair their wells.
I it sounds like we're like all these people know. Let me explain a few things. If you have iron in your water, you know it. Because your toilets are brown, and your sheets are brown, and your towels are brown, and everything you throw in your washing machine are brown. So you get a water filtration system, and you call Tate, and Tate comes and puts it in, and it costs what it costs.
But you don't need someone to...
And then you have clean water. If you have salt in your water, well, the only place that I know of you have salt in the water is if you live in Nantucket, or, very close to the ocean where you have that thin vein of fresh water. And like Smith's Point, for example, there's about a 3-foot line of fresh water that you can hit with a well. And then you go into salt, and that vein, unfortunately, moves up and down, so that most of those people out there now only use that water for showering and toilets, and they bottle in their drinking water. If you live somewhere in the middle of nowhere,
right.
and your toilets aren't brown.
I'm agreeing with you.
Yeah, no,
all
I
right?
know.
Okay.
I'm just like, one side doesn't fit all here.
What about the pollutants that you can't see or can't taste? You know, what if there are pollutants?
And what are those, Matt?
Roberto can tell us, but what if there's lead? What if there's other pollutants in there
which
are possible?
I don't think there's a lot of lead in groundwater. There's mostly from lead pipes that carry it. But, I mean, there are some things. Most people that I know get their well tested every 3 years or 5 years. I just don't like the idea of us telling people they have to test them.
Rick, did you have a question?
Well, I think this is a good discussion, but I think the Board of Health members who all voted in favor of this are not part of this discussion because they're part of the public tonight, Jim, and I guess they have to wait till we're finished up here. So it may be a little one-sided, and all their information filters through Roberto.
We'll hear from them later.
Wanted to go through that. Thank you.
Yes. So in your packets, you actually have all of the data that I collected with all of the contaminant levels that were tested for. And actually, Bobby, there is salt in areas like Cisco, and there is salt in the harbor watershed areas. And there's actually a water well that was drilled this year on Pippin's Way that was pulling up 25 milligrams per liter of nitrogen. That's 5 milligrams per liter of nitrogen above the maximum contaminant level. That can be fixed by a carbon filtration system. So that's just one of the examples moving forward. And people always have the option, like you said, with Nantucket.
Is that going to be in the Shimo sewer?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So now why were you testing wells that were going to be sewer?
It was new construction. It's new construction, so they need to have a potable water source before they cannot get their certificate.
It wasn't related. It was part of that project.
Yeah, it was part of that project.
To your,
so it was a brand new well, and it was pulling up 25 milligrams per liter of nitrogen, of nitrates. They installed a carbon filtration system. The water at retest passed. It actually came back. It came down to 2 milligrams per liter of nitrogen. So those are, that's just one of the examples of where you would see this. And people always have the option, just like in Nantucket, to bring in bottled water for drinking. This is to make sure that people aren't drinking contaminants. We're not forcing people to do all these things just because we feel like being Big Brother. You'll see in your packet as well.
I think that's a... You're drawing a conclusion there. For some of us who think that we, you know, as independent homeowners, we have a responsibility for making sure we have potable water, and we find other ways to do it rather than relying on you. Because I really don't want to give you that responsibility. If I know you're going to come and test it every once in a while, I'll forget about it. I don't want to do that. I would rather keep that responsibility personal.
We're not the ones who are coming in to test it. In the regulation, what it's saying is that...
Well, you just said you're going to start a monitoring program.
Yes.
Wells. Okay.
The regulation
is... Someone, not me, is going to be monitoring the wells.
The regulation is in your packet, and in that packet, the regulation explains that it is incumbent upon the homeowner to have the water tested at a regular interval. The way it's set in the regulation is if you're in a nitrogen-sensitive area, one of the harbor watersheds or any of the watersheds, test your water on an odd year, 2017, 2019, 2021. If you are not in a nitrogen-sensitive area, you should test your water on an even year, 2020, 2022.
So you're not going to come in and test my water?
We're not walking into people's homes to test it.
But you're going to require people to test it.
And yes.
So
okay, this is really more of a philosophical.
I get the watershed areas,
yes.
The harbor watersheds, the palm watersheds. What I don't get is Surfside, Tom Nevers, middle. I mean, there's nothing that's going to change in the groundwater there. My well's down 200 feet. So what's going to change in my well between? If I'm in the even year between 2000 and 2022, or 2018 and 2020,
there's a lot of things.
And other than the fact that you're just telling me I got to do it, so I got to pay it and I got to give you paperwork. It's just, I'm so sick and tired of regulations. We overregulate every friggin' thing in this town to where I feel like I can't walk down the street without somebody's permission.
Okay.
I'm over it.
Okay. So as part of the process of what we're doing, the reasons behind this regulation is to be able to look at this data, to be able to study this data, do trend analysis, do correlation analysis. If you can't study it, if you can't measure it, you can't study it, is the major part of the scientific method. So what I'm trying to do here is to gather the data so that we can do a systematic response with information that we have, up-to-date information. We just had a conversation about how the CWNP or the Massachusetts Estuaries Report might be working off of out-of-date data. So if I'm not collecting that data, I cannot make sound policy decisions.
I get that, Roberto. Let me ask you a precise question. You have 4 people in your department?
Yes, sir.
Do you have the manpower to take on this kind of additional monitoring?
Yes, I do.
All right.
We have the ability to do it.
And you're going to be able to put all these charts and graphs and correlations together? Because it seems to me like we don't have the manpower town-wide to handle all the stuff we do now. We're constantly running, and every department in the town is just stretched to the max. And pushing between septic examinations. You're about to add all these sewer connections to Shimo Monomoy. Somebody's got to monitor all that stuff. I mean, I get it. I get what you're trying to do, and I think it's admirable. But I just don't get to understand why, if somebody isn't in a area that's sensitive, whether it be a harbor watershed or a palm watershed or an area where town water is run. I mean, if they ran town water in front of my house and they said to me, "We want you to test your well because, you know, we're worried about what your water is, and here's town water in case it's bad," great. I'd test it. Boom. I'd hook up if it was bad. But to just say to me, "You're going to test your water," and then, you know,
Roberto, anything else from you?
No. Excellent. Okay. Questions.
Comments or questions from the board? Before we, I know there are a couple of people that want to speak. Any comments or questions?
Yeah, one comment is, how often does someone test it? I had a well for probably 15 years, and I'm guessing that we tested it once.
And that's the problem.
You know, I don't think, Bobby, and it's my fault, but I didn't know, but, you know, I didn't test it.
But what changes in that well, Matt?
Well, our well was one of those. We were over in New Hummock Circle, and it was awful. We had iron in it, and it was ruining everything.
But you could see it.
We saw that, and we fixed it, but then the machines didn't work, so we fixed it again. You know, and then we finally went down about 180 feet, went through the first layer of water and got to the second layer, and it was perfectly fine. But it took me about 15 years to figure that out. And it would have been nice if that were, you know, if that information, and the only reason I got it is I was at the building department asking about wells and checking other people's wells to see if, you know, if they were all right. And someone happened to say, oh, I live half a mile from you. We did this. Went to the second layer. Oh, and I'm thinking, why didn't anyone tell me that before? So, you know, so part of what I think is if you do it and you find an area like, say, where Bobby lives, and you go 2 years or 4 years and there's no issues for a bunch of houses, then you could go 5 or 10. Yeah. But other places you would probably want to go every other year until you understand it. And you don't need to test to have a valid test. You don't need to test everybody. You just need to get, you know, a statistical amount of people in that area, you know, a statistically valid number of people to do it, to know if anything's happening. And I think in some areas it's important. I don't know how you do it or how you incentivize people, whether, you know, I don't know how you do that, but it's important.
Any regulation set by the Board of Health is subject to a variance. So you can get a variance. If you come with a good water test or something like that, you can always get a variance for 5 years, like you said, or 10 years.
Dawn?
In the real estate business, one of the common contingencies for properties that are on a well is when they're selling, they have a water test. The buyer usually orders a water test. And in Tom Nevers, which is not in the Harbor Watershed, I had a water test done, and it came back with a high level of bacteria in it. And it was just because someone had left the cap to the well off, and rodents
happens all the time.
And bugs and things had gotten into it. The homeowners had absolutely no idea, and the whole well had to be flushed with bleach to fix the situation and the cap put back on properly. But it's one of those things where if people don't think to check it, you know, it's like people forget to change filters and that kind of thing. I totally understand the concern that it's another thing that people have to do. So I'd like the process to be as easy as possible.
Oh, absolutely.
But I think it's not a bad idea as far as making sure people stay healthy and their kids stay healthy who have no control over it.
All right. Thank you. I know, Malcolm, did you want to say anything? I know Mr. Greeter does too, but go ahead.
No, I understand all your concerns, but I think a lot of the things we're doing in the watershed area is really for the health of the scallops. So when you said we should only do in this watershed area, we remembered the wells are for the health of the people. And it's our obligation, our legal obligation, our moral obligation of the Board of Health to look out for the welfare and the health of this island. So I think this is a very reasonable regulation. I mean, we make people put in smoke detectors. We do a lot of things that, and I, for one, agree we have maybe too much regulation. But this is a simple health issue. It's not complicated. If your well is fine and the test's fine, you don't have to do anything. This is really to find those wells that are harmful to people. It's simple, not complicated.
Any questions? Change the regulation to say if your well's fine, you don't have to test it for another 5 years. But every 2 years is kind of...
Well, maybe that's what we'll do. I mean, we'll go into this 2 years, and we can adjust. We can see how it goes.
Bobby, my initial recommendation...
Wells, we'll change it.
I had sent an email to Malcolm because one idea, it was to have everybody test initially, get the results back in, take a look at them, see where they lead you, and step B would be whether you have annual, semi-annual, or 5 years, or what you do next. So,
and it could be different areas.
You create a baseline.
So that was a thought.
Well, we'll have that.
Clear. This is not an easy thing to do. You don't just take a bottle of water and take it to somebody and send it up. You got to go get the bottle.
Well, I've done it, Bobby.
Yeah, I know. We've all done it. You know, I mean, I did it to my house when I first moved in. And I did it again like 10 years later, and it was the same result. You know, if you're a smart person or intelligent person, you would do it every now and then. I don't even know why we're having this discussion, because the Board of Health made a ruling that this is going to happen, and we can't overturn.
Oh, we're having a debate here about something that's already been set in stone. So
I think they'll listen to our feedback, and plus we represent.
I think they listen to feedback if it's rational and
I just think
makes
every
sense.
2 years,
we're being very rational.
Listen,
and
in 2 or 3 years, we'll have all the data we'll need. I promised Bobby that I would only serve one more term, so I won't be here for
well,
when
you should serve a couple more, Malcolm.
No. When we have all that data, it will be whoever follows me will have to deal with it, and we'll deal with it in 2 or 3 years. And I think it will be very interesting to have that information. We'll have the same thing that Rick's concerned about. We'll have some more data on the dump. Yep. So we'll move forward.
And Bill, did you want to come up?
I think Bob said I wasn't smart.
I didn't say that.
Thank you, Bill Greeter, Mattaket. If you don't like the regulation now, you'd have hated it in its original form. I will compliment the Board of Health. They did listen to the concerns that the three Mattaket area associations brought forward, such as the ability to do alternative things rather than hook up to town water. We thought that it needed the homeowner or property owner needed to have some options rather than just hook up to town water. The other misconception that was out there is this is not a Mattaket regulation. This is an island-wide regulation, which has come out in discussion tonight. Just one other point on Mattaket. Yes, Mattaket does have water in certain areas. The vast majority of Mattaket does not have water, and according to the Board of Health, Water Department. It is going to be very problematic to get water to these areas, regardless if Joe Blow's well is failing. Because there are so many private ways and roads, they're not about to do any land taking. And if they don't get voluntary easements from property owners, they aren't going to be exercising the option and the expense of forcing water down through these areas. Question we had that we hadn't been answered, and with Roberto here, it'd be a good point to ask him, is this is island-wide, so how is the Board of Health going to notify all of these well owners? There's folks that at this point have no idea, and right now when I bump into people, they go, "Ah, you guys in Mattaket are really getting it shafted. You got to hook up to the wells, to the water," and it's not just Mattaket. So how is that going to get out there to the masses? And I'll sit down so you can answer that. And then while we're talking water quality, I was looking to see if the board had an update to the request that we, the three associations, got for submitting issues to explore for water quality study going forward. And, you know, where does that stand? Is the town buying into the idea that we should be doing isotope testing for contaminants, not just nitrogen, but really identify the stuff that is coming out of the landfill and what's going into our ponds?
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
Libby, you want to take a piece of that?
We had some funding approved at the town meeting, and it's in the next year's budget. So, yes, we are, I think, going to be looking at that, and we haven't gotten quite to the scope that will be put out for an RFP for that kind of study to be done, but we will be working on that, and we will certainly include you and your groups in on the final review.
And Roberto, as to answer the question on notification?
Yes. So the regulation was passed and was effective on April 1st. However, we're in internal discussions right now in the office to create both a mailing campaign, a social media campaign, as well as other venues that we have, PSAs through NCTV. Mailing, individual mailing, and because we've staggered the two different types, both the watershed as well as the non-watershed areas, we have an entire year to notify the next year's portion. So if they want to test it early, they're allowed to test it early. It's not, that's not what we're not saying that you're only allowed to test from January 1st to December 31st of that year. You can test it at any time, and that's all we'll be tracking. We'll be doing that.
Richard?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I certainly have all the respect in the world for the gentleman that that replaced me. He's done a wonderful job. But I have a couple of concerns. Can we go back to the slide that shows the maximum contaminant level? There, okay. These are maximum contaminant levels that you see on the bottom outlined in white, and I have some concerns here. Certainly, anything below 6.5 on the corrosive pH scale is a requirement that's not appropriate. However, on Nantucket, I believe we are doing something into the wind with this one, in the sense that basically the pH on this island is dictated in a large part by the vegetation that we have on the island, pine trees. It became very evident during my tenure that the more pine trees you had on your property, mine, the lower your pH was. So you have to spend a great deal of money and a great deal of time liming your property to even remotely come close to changing that. I don't know if that's going to change that much. Meeting or exceeding the sodium maximum contaminant level. I guess I'd like to see a map at some point, and I know we don't have one now, but a map at some point denoting where the maximum sodium contaminant levels are. I suspect as our shoreline encroaches upon the livability of properties in Nantucket and Surfside and other locations, the freshwater saltwater interface changes dramatically, and those well points that were in freshwater may now be in saltwater. It may be a simple question of relocating a well, but I think this is a natural phenomenon that we're going to see, and we can't change much across the island. The MCL exceedance regarding nutrient loading, nitrogen, nitrates. During my tenure, the concern there, and the only concern at that point, was nutrient-laden waters caused an issue. There's a long medical term for it. Essentially, it's blue baby syndrome. It inhibits the passage of oxygen into the bloodstream. It had virtually no effect on adults. Now, there was a rumor of a concern about cancer, and because I've been out of the field for a couple of years, I guess I want to ask Roberto, has anything changed? Is that still something that's of a concern, or is there anything dynamically associated with that at this point? Has there been any proof to that?
There has been no proof right now. Actually, there was an article in the Journal of the American Medical Association that was released last month that said our cancer rates are actually going down. We are actually we have the largest dip in cancer rates of any county in the United States.
Thank you. I didn't mean to bait you on that one. the nutrient loading is always going to be there because right now we're going to have septic systems. Even with alternative design technology septic systems, you're not going to do away with the nutrient loading, which is why I pushed for sewer. That'll do it. That'll fix it. Thank you.
Matt, do you have a question?
Yeah, just one thing I wanted Roberto to talk about real quick, because he hasn't. It was interesting to me that some of this has to do with harbor water quality, mm-hmm. and that running water means that you're not pulling water out. You can explain it better than I can, but I think it's important for people to understand we're not saying you have to run the water just for your own drinking purposes. Mm-hmm. It helps the water quality.
Matthew, you did your homework.
You should be impressed with me.
I'm just trying to show Bobby that I'm not that way.
You did your homework. In the memo that I have in your packet, I explain how compounding effects of nutrient loading can happen. If you have a well located on your property, let's say it's downstream of a septic system, which most of our septic systems are upstream of a drinking well, We all know what comes out of a septic system. I'll just leave that one there. If you're sucking up nutrient-loaded drinking water, so let's say it's at 9 milligrams per deciliter, and it comes into your water at 9 milligrams per deciliter, you use it for washing your dishes, using the restroom, using taking showers, things like that. It goes into your septic system at approximately 49 milligrams per deciliter. Then it gets dropped out through natural denitrification or things like that. That will bring it down to, let's say, 10 milligrams per deciliter. Well, that water that is now with that extra milligram per deciliter of nitrates, for example, can migrate and enter into another potable water well, which can get sucked up again and then compounded. So when it gets back put back into the groundwater, it's now at 11 milligrams per deciliter. And that groundwater can get recycled, and we get that nitrogen compounding in our groundwater. IA systems bring nitrogen down to, at the minimum, 19 milligrams per liter or below. However, it is still dropping nitrogen into the groundwater. The only way to remove 100% of that nitrogen is through sewers. However, if you are bringing in and connecting to town water, which by law, a public drinking source cannot have more than, I believe it's 5 milligrams per liter, and I'll have to go back and take a look again. That compounding is much less. So you're no longer pulling water out of the groundwater. You are bringing clean water in that is not loaded with nutrients, that gets cycled through your house, goes into your septic system, gets naturally denitrified, then enters the groundwater. So there is multiple levels of dilution here. You're no longer pulling water out of the groundwater, therefore concentrating it more. You are actually adding cleaner water into that groundwater, which increases flushing in the groundwater. And when somebody downstream pulls that water up in their potable drinking water well, it is now no longer in that compounded level of nutrient loading.
Or when it makes it to the harbor.
When
it makes it to the harbor, it's cleaner.
It's much cleaner because it is much more diluted.
If it had been compounding.
Exactly.
Okay.
Well, one last question.
All right.
The rules in place, you want everybody to test. What happens to somebody if they don't test?
We're not trying to hammer people over the head with a cocaine
mallet. I understand,
mallet.
But what is the consequences?
So,
because not everybody's going to do this. I can tell you that right now. So are you going to fine them? You're going to like bang on the door and...
Usually what we do is...
Stick a big red sticker on the window? What are we going to do?
No, exactly. Usually what we do is we send the first letter saying, please test your well. We send second letter, third letter. After that third letter, it takes approximately 6 months to do that information. After that third letter, then we post the property. It's exactly what we're doing right now with all of our septic system compliance. Then we post the property. We actually put that letter on the door. If at that point they don't respond, then we can send them a fine. The fine is set by Chapter 21D, so it can be anywhere from $25 to $100. We're not going to be just beating people with $100 fines every day.
And walk me through the process of getting your well tested. You have to go to the Board of Health and get a bottle.
So you pick up a bottle from any of the pharmacies on island.
And that's a cost for that.
They're about a dollar.
Okay.
You can then you take your aerators off a faucet, or you go to your outside spigot. You let the water run for 10 minutes. Then you fill up the water. Make sure you don't touch the neck of the water to the spigot. Fill it up, close the bottle, bring it to the Board of Health, and it is in the board on Tuesdays. We do that water testing. It is $5 to the town of Nantucket, and it's $45 to the Barnstable County Laboratory.
So we send it to Barnstable.
It has to be done by an EPA certified laboratory.
One day a week.
Or you can get Tate to do it. Or you can get Mark Gazai to do it.
So there's the potential here when this happens and we say we're going to do this. You could get literally 500 bottles on a Tuesday.
We can.
And can you handle 500 bottles on a Tuesday?
We have about 10 coolers right now. And they hold about 10 to 20 depending on the size of the cooler.
Okay.
Leslie.
So get a bottle. Go bottle to bottle.
giant bottle of Fuji water. Pour your bottle and take it in.
Bobby,
that's up to you. The only person they're hard.
No, that's the thing. I mean, you're just assuming people are.
Go ahead, Leslie.
If you test Poland Springs water, the only person you're harming there is yourself.
Testing for septic systems took repeated extensions of the deadline, repeated letters. Education. It was no different than this exercise.
I don't argue it. I think it's just excessive to do it every year, every 2 years, whatever your plan. I think that if your well is clean, you should say 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, whatever.
And we can always revisit that.
So, Leslie, go ahead. Welcome.
Thank you. Leslie Forbes, Mattigan. I have two points I want to make. One is notification. Most people don't even know whether they're in a needs area or not, I would venture to say. And most people, as you said before, do not watch Board of Health meetings on TV or attend them or even come to Board of Selectmen meetings. Sorry. So this is a very far-reaching and expensive set of regulations for particularly people in Mattigan. It's going to come as a big surprise to seasonal residents when they come back in June and July. So, yes, a letter campaign. When the planning board was changing zoning in Mattigan, a big zoning change, not a little zoning change, a big one in 2009, they sent letters to everybody whose property could be affected by this, and then invited them to a meeting. There were maps everywhere, there were charts, questions. It was a very thorough discussion, and people arrived. Just last summer, when sewer was something that was going to, that Mattigan people wanted to know about, there was another public hearing that in this room, and the room was full. So, two things. The Board of Health, I think, should be required to have a hearing on both the septic and the water regulations that have gone into place. And there should be written notification to property owners, because they're not going to know whether they have to test their well. And then on the septic thing, you know, they go to put an addition on their house, and it's like, oh, did you know you have to put an IA in order to put this addition on? It's going to come as big news. So that's number one.
I think we heard that there had been two public hearings.
There were two public hearings.
They were in March. They were in February and March.
And
they were.
There have been two public hearings. So. And I'm sure
and
there'll be more.
Furthermore, Leslie, you were at that meeting where the Board of Health specifically said that, yes, we will hold a public forum in July regarding these two regulations.
That's correct. And I'm announcing it again at a Board of Selectmen meeting.
Okay. Just making sure that people know that we are planning that already.
Thank you. And you were responsive. Yes. The second thing is referring to what Bill was talking about and Libby answered, and Rick spoke too as about the data that is driving a lot of these decisions. I do have the technical memorandum update for 2006 put out by SMAST and Woodward and Curran. And it's very... the trend line is going the right way. The estuaries are getting cleaner. And the dump, and they're tying a lot of it to the cleanup of the dump, the mining at the dump. So it's asking for more more extensive understanding of the contribution from the dump to Long Pond. Then it goes Long Pond to Mattigan Ditch to Hither Creek, Hither Creek to Mattigan Harbor. So I want to make sure that that stays on the town's agenda. I understand you have money now, and that this is going to happen. Mr. Carlson, at that same Board of Health hearing that I attended, talked about letting a contract for doing nitrate testing at the 8 monitoring wells that are already in existence around the dump. And indeed, this report says it's time to do it. So I want to make sure that that moves forward as well.
So I just comment on that. And we really have Rick to thank for pushing that effort forward to the board. We've appropriated budgeted $200,000 to do a package of things, and I'm sure this board, current and future members, will take that
follow through on it.
follow through.
So that brings me to my last point, which is when that data comes together, and I see a time when maybe we would come to the Board of Health with different data and say, I assume that's what you do, and then say, would you consider a change to these regulations that you've put in because the underlying data has changed? Is that the proper way to go about it?
Absolutely. We always work off the most accurate data that we have.
Thank you.
Thank you, Leslie. Is there anyone else in the public who'd like to come up and comment or ask a question about this matter?
Encourage people to come to our meetings.
So we encourage you to come to the Department of the Board of Health meetings. It sounds like they're pretty exciting. It sounds like they also listen to the folks that come and take their comments at public hearings well and make adjustments. So, yes, Cormac.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Cormac for the Nantucket Land Council. I believe Libby sent you guys an email, I think it was yesterday or today. It was just a forward of something that I shared with Roberto and the Board of Health a few days ago, and then Jeff and the Conservation Commission, in regards to looking at the landfill a little bit further, and some follow-up thoughts on that. I think what hasn't been stated yet, but it probably is a good venue too, and in that the Board of Health has asked for a quote audit by the Department of Environmental Protection on the landfill, existing activities as it relates to the ACO, the Administrative Consent Order, but then also as it relates to any applicable rules and regulations and just basically daily operations and activities. That's a great starting point. And then also an additional investigation of the water quality analysis. What has sort of been lost in this is that the town and waste options have to monitor quarterly all 8 wells anyways. So we have a wealth of data since 2001. There's additional supplementary testing for total nitrogen that definitely has to happen, and probably some phosphorus as well, and then some additional supplementary testing along the shoreline and perhaps digging a couple more wells. But I think we're well on the way, as Roberto has stated and as Jeff stated, to getting a little bit better understanding of the landfill. And my letter was to help push that along. Thank you.
Bobby?
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to throw up one bit of advice to the Board of Health and to the Natural Resources Department on my way out the door. And it has to do with something that somebody showed me this week of some aerial drone footage of the draining ponds, the whatever you call the ponds at the landfill, this summer that somebody took with a drone. And I would suggest that the town, either through the Board of Health or through Natural Resources Department or through town administration, find the money to buy a drone. They're not that expensive. I have one. They're pretty easy to fly, believe it or not. And we should have our own drone to fly aerial surveys on a weekly or biweekly basis over some of these estuaries where you get ground runoff from whatever, whether it be the landfill or construction sites. You can see so much from a drone at 500 feet that you can't see from the ground riding around in a vehicle. And I think the money would be well spent for us to monitor pond openings, vegetation buildups in these ponds, algae blooms, all these things you could see from the air very readily with a drone. And it's less than $1,000, and they're easy to fly, and the video is easy to download, and then it's data that we'll always have. So it just goes, Roberto, to all the stuff that you're talking about monitoring. You put the video with the monitoring. I think it would be money well spent for the town.
Yes,
Robbie, on that photo, could you see, you know, runoff into the ponds from the landfill? Because I saw the letter; it was pretty obvious.
And I asked the person who took it to send me the video, and they didn't want to do it. But it would be good if we had our own, because, you know, you drive in there and look, and you can't see from the road.
That's pretty powerful image.
It's you know, it's a thing that we could fly it over the dump. We could fly it over the creeks. We could fly it over the mosquito ditches. We could fly it over the harbor. You could see the rust tide plumes. You can see all these things from the air that you can't see you know, at ground level.
And so, Bobby, at the dump, all that does is take me back to some of our discussions about why we're building line landfills to keep stuff on island forever. And I have to continue to monitor and watch the runoff and take drone pictures when it may not be necessary to keep it here in the first place.
I just think, you know, it's a short amount of money for a really valuable tool.
I'm all for that. I'm just repeating a message.
Cormac.
Yeah, thanks. I think this is fairly important that I have to make this statement. If Bobby's video can coordinate with Roberto in terms of where that surface water impoundment was, they also do testing. The town, through Waste Options, does testing on the surface water impoundment areas. And what Roberto and I have seen in terms of the results, they're, in terms of heavy metals, they're quite alarming, quite scary. So I think if that is overflowing into the wetlands and then into the long pond.
The dike was cut, what I saw. And they won't give me the video, unfortunately, because I would love to give it to Roberto and say, here it is. But
a friendly suggestion to look at this tomorrow, Friday, Monday. It seems that it might be something that is more than just something.
It shouldn't be hard to track down a friendly drone.
I have one you can use.
Who's one?
If I could also say this, something about the drone, this is town-owned property. We can have town employees just go out and see if it's the dike is broken.
This is something that happened in August of last summer.
Okay.
And I just saw the footage. So it's not now.
That's good to know.
I saw it, and I requested an investigation. It was done, and it wasn't happening now. But this was something that happened last summer, from what the individual told me, and he didn't want to give me the footage, but I think if we had our own drone and once every couple of weeks we flew it around these areas, it saves a heck of a lot of time. And you driving around and walking through the bushes, whacking away with a machete trying to see what's there, you know,
500 so
feet
much fun.
Is you know, it's a big difference. I mean, I bought mine because I use it to fly in front of the boat to look for tuna, and it works really well as long as I can land it back in the cockpit without crashing in the water. You're not going to have that problem. You'll be able to land it wherever you want.
But I think to Rick's point, I think the monitoring's great, the drones are great, but wouldn't it be nicer if we just took the problem off the table and look for another way to get rid of our waste? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next, I'm going to open a public hearing to consider an application for new seasonal wine malt beverages with cordials liquor restaurant license for J.K. Shack LLC. Amy, good evening.
Good evening. So this evening we are considering a application for a new liquor license. This liquor license would be located at 10 Straight Wharf and under the management of two current liquor licenses, which would be at Kitty's and Queequeg's in town, which is one license, same management. Now this location, this would be a change of use for this location.
Just clarify, this is one license for all three?
No, I'm sorry. I was just referring to the management that is applying for this license manages those two establishments as well. So has history on the island with those two licenses. This location, as I said, is a change of use. It was prior retail, real estate, those sorts of things. It has not had a liquor license, so this would be a new liquor license. We included with you some comments specifically from Chief Pittman that I'm going to refer to. The recommendation is there's some great concern about approving a liquor license in this location for several reasons that I'll give you to consider under state regulations and guidelines for considering these types of things. But as Chief Pittman referred to the location, we're talking about a location in Straight Wharf area. We currently have four main licensed premises that have outdoor bars. Again, this location is asking for the bar to be located outdoors. I think we have included a outline of the premises that they wish to have. There'll be outdoor seating and some indoor seating. Yeah, we can put up that map. And again, this is under construction. This is just the preliminary stages of this. So the bar that they're requesting would be outdoors. There would be service indoors and outdoors. There's also a ice cream counter indoors. Where they're seating, you'll see here where that bar is. That is outdoors facing Straight Wharf and that sidewalk there with outdoor seating directly. Thank you. directly on the street. A couple concerns. You have an ice cream counter indoors. Why am I not getting that? Sorry, I can't operate a pointer. The ice cream counter is indoors, also where you're having indoor seating here, service, the bar. Obviously, ice cream counters are going to attract families and children, along with a bar set up here as well. As I was starting to say, in the area we have four other licensed establishments with outdoor bars, being Tavern, Gazebo, Straight Wharf Restaurant, and Crew. But all four establishments, drawing significant crowds during the day. As Chief Pittman stated in his letter, the police department has already had to divert a significant number of our seasonal staff, many of whom do not have police powers, to the Straight Wharf area at night to deal with this traffic and pedestrian issues, as well as those that inevitably result from patrons being overserved at these locations to the detriment of patrols elsewhere. It is in his opinion that we're at the tipping point already with the existing establishments and the staff that we have available. If we look at the big picture, we are at 96 liquor licenses at high season right now, which, based on our seasonal residents, puts us in the top 10 of the state as far as number per capita there. With this application, and I have three others out there, we're going to be at 100 should these all go through. So that's another consideration, as that big picture in the past 20 years has doubled the number of liquor licenses and certainly events that provide alcohol without adding to our resources and public safety to deal with these situations. I think another consideration that we've discussed is the location. As far as where it is, the other four bars that do have outdoor seating obviously have larger areas that are off the street for gathering and those sorts of things. I think the recommendation is, no matter what the decision is that there can be no queuing out on that sidewalk. We're concerned about it bottlenecking an already very congested area, throwing people into the street, being distracting in that area as well. There are residential neighbors, apartments above buildings next door to it as well. That's a concern with noise and other things. I think if it is considered to be approved, there are several conditions that we would ask be placed on this. Timing, I think they've asked to serve up to 1 a.m. We would ask that it be 10 p.m. at most. We'd have to obviously consider the traffic, there being queuing, no queuing outside on the sidewalk. That service, similar to the decision with Graydon House and an outdoor patio and per state regulations, that service be limited to people sitting having a meal where food is available. That it's not similar to the other establishment like the Tree Bar, where it's a bar situation and there's people hanging out in a bar type of setting. That condition be on it as well. And another condition to consider, if you do consider approval, is similar to other municipalities, they put a limit as to how long a approval is valid. In Cambridge, for instance, put 6 months on should you approve it, because there's so much work to be done and so many permits to go through, that your decision is valid for a certain amount of time that they have to kind of put this together and get through as well. So to make that a consideration as well. Any questions so far on those?
We'll hear from the from the applicant. Mr. Wilson, are you representing the applicant?
I am. Thank you, Chairman Kelly and members of the board. Michael Wilson on behalf of John Keene, who is the principal of the JK Shack LLC. That's your applicant before you. Three applications, all sort of going hand in hand. What you have before you is the schematic of the proposed layout. There is not any proposal to have seating on the sidewalk, and I don't know if that was a misstatement, but it's all proposed to be wholly within the premises inside
I don't think she said that, so go ahead.
On the roadway or on the sidewalk. Yeah, it's also going to be inside of a fence. The HDC is already, I know that this board doesn't concern themselves with that, but the fence has been approved, and the style that the HDC has approved is all on the property proper, not out on the traveled way. With respect to the concerns passed along by Ms. Baxter from the chief, there's 11 restaurants in town that all have outdoor eating areas, all in direct proximity to a sidewalk. Crew, Straight Wharf, Gazebo, Tavern, Slip 14, Boarding House, Graydon House, Jetties, Lobster Trap, Town, and Queequeg's. There are an additional 7 restaurants in town that I wouldn't say are characterized as being proximate to a sidewalk, but have outdoor dining service. Languedoc, Dune, Jared Coffin, Met on Main, White Elephant, Lola, and then you have the private establishment, the Anglers Club. So with respect to...
I don't know how the Anglers Club considered on a street, Mr. Wilson.
No, I didn't say it's on a street. I differentiated the first 11 as being directly proximate to a sidewalk, and the next 7 as being serving outdoor dining. And so the concerns were noise. That is an issue that is readily controllable, and there's nothing proposed different with this use than any of the other in-town uses that would make this more of a noise issue. If anything, we benefit from the location being directly proximate to an area that the chief has identified as already heavily patrolled. You have the boat coming in from the High Line. You have the gazebo, the Straight Wharf, and the tavern, all right there. And so to the extent that this is going to propose an additional challenge to our limited police officer resource, I would just part ways with the chief on that. We have police officers right here already for the other locations. If you take a look at the menu and the fact that, as Ms. Baxter proposed, the other application for the common victualler license anticipates a takeout ice cream counter. And you look at the menu that the applicants proposed also, this is a family-oriented seafood takeaway, small portions, is not fine dining and long-term sitting down. And while it's true that children are drawn to the ice cream counter, they will be accompanied by their parents, who may also be drawn to the lunch table where they may have a wine or a beer. So with respect to the interaction between children and adults, it would be no different than Jetties or any other family-oriented location. What is different and distinguishable about this, and you can see the photo, is unlike the other establishments that are seated right out on the sidewalk, specifically the tavern, and you see how Straight Wharf is oriented as well. This is set back. This is in the front yard. The building itself is set back off the traveled way. There is proposed with the fence and the gate to be a manager station, so there would be a control. Just like any other location that has the manager kiosks out front, like Dune, like Graydon House, like Languedoc, place where you will have a control by on the staff management, who's going to be able to control in and out, making sure that it's a safe location. So with those responses to the raised concerns, I'd ask the board to consider favorably this application. Considering also, as Ms. Baxter pointed out, Mr. Keene has a combined total of 40 years of operating restaurants here on Nantucket. That's 16 years for Queequeg's, 14 years for Kitty Murtaugh's, 7 years for Town, and 3 years for the Hen House. And he suggests to me that he can't count more than 3 noise complaints for any of those establishments over those years. Chief takes exception to that. He can come up or
go ahead,
chortle from the back.
Go ahead. But just finish your presentation.
To the extent that that is the concern.
So we're gonna let him finish, and then we'll have comments.
To the extent that the noise is a concern, it would be moving forward, anticipating that noise is going to be a concern, rather than a track record, and rather than what we have in the area. The other very close, proximate tavern, gazebo, Straight Wharf, Crew.
Anything else?
No.
Amy, any comments? I think, okay, all right. I was going to, we could, do you want to, just any comments from you or?
Yeah, I think, with all due respect, I think maybe made some of my points there with some of those locations is to the number that we have in that area and needing to add to it, and that it is a family-friendly menu with ice cream and such, and it is very small, compact area. I don't think it compares to some of those other locations that we discussed. And as far as noise violations, unfortunately, we've had 3 with town since January. And there's certainly a lot more than that over the past. So I think that's an inaccurate statement. And we're concerned about, obviously, setting up another location as such. I know that's not his intention, but the bar itself, the fence is going to go up on that sidewalk, and there'll be tables right along it. That was my remark before, not that they're on the sidewalk, but pretty much attached to it with no other outlet like the tavern and those locations that are outlet out into the dock area. So.
Thank you. So this is a public hearing. It's been noticed in the newspaper, and we'd like to invite anyone from the public who would like to come and speak to us about this matter. Welcome. If you could just identify yourself.
Hi, my name is Erin Schrader. I'm here with the Alliance for Substance Abuse Prevention. As has been pointed out, there are 96 alcohol establishments, retailers on the island. This places us as one of the highest per capita in the state, and I would argue also nationally that places us one of the highest alcohol retailers in the country. So one more alcohol establishment in a community that has significant issues and is struggling significantly with alcoholism and substance abuse, it is our position as an organization that this is excessive and not warranted. We also have concerns about accessibility for underage youth accessing alcohol at a market that sells ice cream and liquor. It's our position that this is unnecessary. Thank you.
Thank you, Erin. Anyone else from the public who'd like to speak on this?
Hi, my name. My name is Darcy Creech. I have lived downtown since 1995. I live right smack in the center of town. And
what's your residence? Just so
16 and a half Federal Street. Okay. I'm landlocked. I'm behind the boarding house, Company of the Cauldron, Center Street Bistro. Town is a half a block from me. I've never heard town. I have called the police on the boarding house after 1 o'clock. But when you live in town, noise and people going out to dinner and all that, people making noise after they've had drinks at night, it's part of living in town. And if you don't like it, then you shouldn't be sleeping in town or whatever. It's a part of town life. I think that John has been an amazing neighbor, and I think his restaurant's great. I love the concept of it. It's like a Jetty's Beach in town, and I think there's not enough of that. There really isn't a place a lot of people, a lot of families can go with their kids. So I understand the substance abuse thing, but you know, that those are, I feel like it would be unfair not to allow this. I would approve it.
Thank you for that. Yes.
Hi, Maria Zoda. I'm afraid I'm on the other side for a number of reasons. Number one is the 96 liquor licenses we already have, and the drug and alcohol problem on Nantucket is an epidemic. That area in particular, it's a traffic area to the boats. I think it's going to be a nightmare for Bill Pittman. The restaurateurs have done a good job, but this is just not the place for this tightly knit selling ice cream and liquor establishment, so I don't think it's a good idea.
Thanks. Anyone else from the public who'd like to speak? Our next step is to close the public hearing, so this is your opportunity to come and speak. All right, we'll close the public hearing and ask Amy and the applicant to come up and take questions from the board. Dawn?
I'm worried about the combination of and the layout of what's being proposed here. And I'm worried that the plan isn't, it just doesn't look like it's drawn to scale. I'm not really seeing where the chairs are and how it's all gonna work, where a hostess is gonna stand to manage the stuff. It's just, it's not, it feels a little bit vague. And I guess my first question is, what happens when it's raining?
We close.
You're just closed. Sure you're not planning to propose an awning later?
Not coming back for an awning. At worst, we'd do collapsible umbrellas the same as we have at Queequeg's, just small, non-marked, non-advertising mirrors. Not mirrors, umbrellas.
Okay. When you have a popular ice cream shop, as we all know, the line can go out and way around the corner and down the sidewalk. And then if you have a popular bar in the same place, same thing. So I'm a little bit worried about how much is trying to get put into this area. And it's not that I don't think that these are good things. I'm just really worried about how it's going to function and the fact that that sidewalk's not adequate right now as it is with people coming off that high line.
From the entrance, the front door, sorry.
No, go ahead.
From the entrance to the front door is 20 feet, and we propose that the patrons of the ice cream shop then walk down towards the wharf side and go in through the small door right in front of the counter and queue out that side and then leave the property. That makes a total of 42 linear feet of line on property without anybody standing outside, and we could restrict it that nobody is allowed on the patio, on the sidewalk.
Can you describe the fence, how high it is? You said it's been approved by the HTC.
If we could go back to the photo, Erica, please. That would show the door to the right that John was just referring to. Need to.
As far as I know, it's a standard picket fence, about 34 inches tall, capped, and painted white.
You show a shelving area, John.
Sorry, Bobby?
Is that a shelving area off the fence for those tables in your drawing?
That's a banquette.
What's that mean? You're going to have
a bench,
back to
a
it?
Bench seat with a back to it, and then tables in front, and then chairs in front of the house.
I'm going to let everybody else.
So just to be clear, is that going to be higher than the fence?
No, the cushion will be at the same height as the back of the fence.
They're just handing me something. I don't think it's in the packet.
That's not in the packet. That's from the HTC. It's the depiction of the fence in the front of the building, if any member wants.
It's in the packet.
There it is.
There.
I guess a question about the liquor aspect, John. You're asking all out full alcohol?
Yes.
Okay.
Beer and wine with cordials.
Yeah. Wine, malt checked. Beverage, and cordials / liquors. This is a new category?
It's an existing category. We don't have any.
We don't have any. This is a new to Nantucket.
No. Are you saying that you wanted all alcohol?
Yes.
Okay, well, that's what was checked on the application, so that's what we're saying. So we would be certainly...
That's not what this... So this application is not coming in as an all alcohol.
No, it came in with beer and... checked beer and wine with malt. Could have been you checked the wrong thing.
So if that's the case, we can't...
We would have to just adjust it before sending it. I think they just checked the, it's a drop-down.
It was advertised. What was it advertised as?
It was advertised as beer and wine. It should have been.
Well,
if
they want actually all alcohol, then
have to come back.
You have to go through a new process, right?
If they want, we would be further against that.
The reason I'm asking is the difference. If you're doing, if you're doing a Shake Shack sort of place, and parents are having a beer or two, and it's not a bar, that's one thing. If you're actually doing a bar with outside seating, then that's a different impact. If you're doing a small restaurant impact. With an occasional beer, I probably wouldn't be opposed to that. If it's going to be an outside bar, then I think we have more issues.
Well, so just to clarify, if I could clarify from the applicant, so you want us to move forward with this application, or are you going to come back with the full alcohol? Your decision.
I'm a little bit confused. Beer, wine, and malt. Malt is liquor.
It would be beer and wine with cordials was what was selected. So that's just the category of beer and wine.
But it's not a all alcohol.
It wouldn't be liquor. It wouldn't be.
Did we ask for cordials?
That was what was checked. So it wouldn't
cordials.
Be cordials. Yep. It wouldn't be.
Cordials.
Or
it wouldn't be vodka, rum.
No. Correct.
Cocktails.
Which we'd be further against all alcohol in that location.
What falls
you want
under
to think
cordials?
About it, or do you want to? Hmm? We need an answer.
What falls under cordials exactly?
Can I make my like comments while he's thinking about it?
Well, we need to clarify.
Could we get some direction from the board as to their feelings?
Well, we can't. No, we're gonna. We either stop talking about this now, and you give us another application for all alcohol, or we review this and make a decision about it, and then that's it. So, if you want to come back with all alcohol, you need to come back with another application.
In a month,
correct?
It
could be amended
deferred.
Now.
Yeah, it could be amended. We've done that before. Where we
even without the, even though it was advertised as a.
No.
It would have to be another public.
Yeah, we need to put. Another public hearing.
Yeah, I'm going to just say one thing that certain, as far as our recommendation, would absolutely not be for all alcohol. That if this was approved, it would be beer and wine only with service to tables. Would be the absolute recommendation. We have done it before where someone asked for all alcohol and we asked them to come back with beer and wine for the bakery across from the school.
So we're just narrowing, not expanding.
Right, yeah.
It's a big difference.
Yeah, so, I mean, they're welcome to pursue that, but I'm going to tell you what that recommendation
is
right now.
What's your decision?
I think we'll come back and regroup.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
So I don't have to make any comments?
I guess not.
Awesome.
So we will also defer Amy
anyway,
the.
Right? I was really so looking for. I knew what it was going to be. I'm so looking
well,
forward.
Well, I will make one comment to you, to the board going out. I've never approved a liquor license where the only service bar was outside.
Yeah.
That's something to be think about. You know, weather is a contributing factor in Nantucket, and I don't see any place inside to mix or pour drinks. So.
Okay.
Yeah,
May I ask, as far as I know, continuing the alcohol portion, if they're asking to continue both?
I mean, resubmit,
but are they doing that as well with the CV and entertainment portions?
You want to ask them?
If they'd like to continue with those two, that would be my question, that hearing this evening.
He would like to pull the entertainment and the CV application
both
as well
at this time?
So they can come in.
Yep.
Withdrawing everything.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Please.
I think it's great. We'll come back.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Town manager report, Libby.
As the board will recall, there's been some discussion about the proposed Harbor Place development, and as a result of that, there's been some discussion about the possibility of a transit or transportation center. And there, the board also had some discussion about the possibility of engaging a consultant that specializes in that type of operation. And we've got a couple of consultants that are well known that specialize in that sort of thing. They're listed in your packet along with some information, and I think our current understanding is that if, as we are proceeding with this development, or the private developers are proceeding with it, and to the extent that the town is interested in getting involved in the transportation aspect of it, that the developer would fund for the town the services of a consultant, probably depending on overall cost and scope, but would fund it, not have any control over who we select or what our process is, but would fund the services. So we just wanted to, I think, share with the board what has been come up with so far for consultants.
And Rick, this really comes back to the comment you made a couple of months ago that we really need independent consultant.
Mm-hmm.
And that's who we're. That's these are some.
Is this in response to that?
Yes.
I'll just give you my first reaction is that these guys seem to be 85% parking consultants. Now I may be wrong on that, and I think the
No, actually, they're transit center, intermodal transit center.
I didn't park. Intermodal transit center, which might have a parking element. But either way, my sense of what we need helping us out here is much broader than focusing on one small aspect of the development. I think the town needs to consider streetscapes, building heights, mix of what's in there, all kinds of things, Jim, where this seems to be focused on the intermodal transportation center, which might be fine, but I think that's a little different from my initial thoughts on how we approach the town's interest in the overall scope of the project.
But that's kind of where we are now. That's like, I think everyone agrees, but go ahead.
So on my way out the door?
Yeah.
On my way out the door, I got to stop saying that. I'm sorry. When I was chair, one of the things that I tried to do was to try to have a quarterly meeting between the planning board and the Board of Selectmen. I can't think of a more pertinent piece of development that needs input from both boards.
So we've done that, actually. Not so much on these, but we've had the chairman and vice chair of the planning board, the staff, Don and I. And that's where we came with
great.
The priority of
I think
the
that
center.
When you hire a consultant, it should be one consultant that covers the needs of both boards.
Absolutely.
Because we're talking, in this case, Rick, I believe that the primary concern of the Board of Selectmen is pedestrian traffic and parking. But the planning board will look at, like, building heights and streetscapes. And I think it's going to be the best possible thing for the town is for the two boards to work together as one with one consultant, because this is the most important piece of development for the next 100 years for Nantucket. It's going to shape the downtown. And we have an opportunity here to work with the developers and not work against the developers. I remember what happened with Great Harbor Yacht Club and how that turned out, and I feel like we missed an opportunity there, and I'd hate to see us miss an opportunity here. So,
Bobby, I don't think that's I'm not fighting that at all. And I agree with you on the planning board.
Right.
I just sharing my first
right.
reaction.
This might not be the right consultant.
Guys,
right.
They, I may be wrong, but, you know, they seem fairly focused. And maybe they can provide the broader services, but it might be better to have a firm that provides a broader service and then focus down on this as an element of where we end up. Anyway, that's my thinking here.
Dawn?
Anyway. I feel like in the scope of this entire potential Harbor Place project and all of the components of it, that we need to identify a point person, whether it's someone within the town or someone that's hired by the town, as our local point person to maybe, you know, get a report from an organization like this that specifically focuses on parking options and other things like that, but that brings the whole scope of it together and brings the different entities like the planning board and the Board of Selectmen together. I mean, I think that we made a mistake with some of our larger projects by not definitely having someone working on it from day one who knew all of the things that needed to be addressed. I think we things would have gone a lot smoother with the Island Home if we'd thought of doing something like that. And sometimes it's about money constraints and all of the other pressures. So I just think that that's something we should really consider.
But just so you know, I mean, we haven't met since November, but I'm working on my memory. But the transit center was a town project.
Correct.
And we all agreed that it was a town project, planning board and Don and I, and that we said this was going to be our first, first component of it. We really haven't talked about all the other components, and I hear, maybe we should, because to put it into some context, if that's what you're saying, but
I think they're going to be related, because the as I understand this, the developers' initial thoughts were to grant or gift some property to the town for this. So I don't think the developers are, I think it's clearly interrelated. In other words, you don't just say, I'll give you this, and without considering the pros and cons and trade-offs of the larger development.
And there's a whole bunch of items that even, okay, they give us a piece of land for a transit center. We build a transit center. We use the diff. I'm just throwing these ideas out there. We use the diff and we build a transit center. How do we get people to use a transit center? Do we instill a paid parking in the whole downtown area? You know,
so
and
these
then
are all questions for an expert.
Right, and
so
these are things that
one of these consultants.
Exactly, and
that's why we got it. That's where our thoughts are. We
right, can, and I think it's great
forward.
That we're very early in the process. Yeah. We're starting to ask these questions instead of after the process. Yeah. So
if we, you know, my suggestion is to let us go forward, ask town administration to go forward and at least interview these consultants, maybe make them have them come and make a presentation, and then we could. You know, I think we decide if that's the way we want to move forward. But right now, I don't have anything really to react to.
I think that's fair. I think a presentation back here. I was going to ask about the process because I know some months ago, part of the process was there was a series of questions about whether the, I hate to use the word committee, but the work group committee
right.
was going to be meeting in public sessions.
Right.
And I think the understanding...
We said yes, but we haven't had one since.
Right, but yet, we haven't had one yet, but here we are.
You no, but it's because that's this, this
okay,
is the...
But
we talked
I think,
about this in November. We did.
Right. We did, yeah.
But I think to jump internally to having two candidates about this without a further discussion, I think is a long time, Jim. So I would encourage some more open discussions. I think, you know, there are other... town parties that need to start getting alert, community parties, to the way this is going to play out. And sort of picking up on your comment, Dawn, to, if necessary, to reach out and engage them early on rather than having the meeting and saying, well, you never showed up. So I think we can identify groups that will have an interest in the overall plan, and the sooner we get them involved, Jim, the better off we're going to be.
But I want to know who's going to identify, who's going to be the point person on this, because
well,
I don't think that that's something that Libby can manage on top of
exactly.
everything else.
Yeah.
Someone needs to own
who's
this.
The boss?
Yeah, who's going to own it?
Yeah,
we don't.
And
I don't know if
boss?
We, so maybe that's where we go back. We ask town administration to come back with some ideas about who that is, if you want to do that before we talk to consultants, or they may have some ideas. You've done it in X number of other cities. What do towns do who have budgetary constraints but want to have a project? So,
a lot of these are big cities where they've done these projects too, so it just the overlap might not be quite the same with
yeah,
how we function.
I just went to their website and, you know, sort of moved around a little bit and looked at some of the towns, and it, and almost every picture is of a major intermodal transportation center that in terms of scale is totally different from what we're going to be doing, I think, Jim. So,
but I think
doesn't mean they don't have the talents to do it.
No, but I think, you know, it's just maybe a lesson from our Island Home. I mean, we did a lot of outreach for the Island Home, and the groups we spoke to said this is a wonderful idea and let's move forward. We obviously were speaking to the wrong people. So I think consultants could help us identify, as you've gone through these projects, who do you talk to? How do you engage the community? And that's an expertise that I don't know that we have.
Yeah, I'm not fighting on that.
Yeah, I don't disagree.
I thought one community was interesting when you worked your way through these, which you all might want to look at. Instructive a little bit reminded me of our Island Home, and that was the parking facility in... a New Jersey community, I think it's Ridgewood. Just
isn't that your hometown?
No, it's not. It's similar, but not at all my. And it's not my hometown. It's my wife's hometown. It's Summit, New Jersey. But they went through a whole process and had a public vote and had a this and consultants and all kinds of things, and then they finally had another vote, a whole period of time later, and. Voila, it didn't pass. So that's different from our island home, but in some ways similar. So it just points out the risks that you got to really work on this. So.
My comment, I think it's important to look at the, you know, the parking garage and the whole parking downtown. It has to be wide enough to encompass everything, you know, and we need someone with that expertise. I wouldn't be, I think we need someone in that parking world who can, and we've done a lot of the studies already, but someone that can pull what we've done already together. I think sometimes the outreach is premature. You know, when we don't know what we're doing, we don't even know what the recommendations are, and we're calling people in to do outreach, that's when it becomes a mess, because you're saying, well, we might do this and we might do that, and this might be important for this reason, and the conversations never go well. I think you have to really have a vision and know what you're trying to do first. And so I think the consultant has to show us, you know, here's your problem, here's how we recommend you address it, and here's, you know, here's how it'll work. And then we sort of outreach and say, how does that look? But too often we're, you know, it needs to be more specific. And the people who are doing it have to understand it well enough that they can answer the question simply. Like, you can't have someone go off into numbers or into things people don't understand. If you understand something really well, you can explain it really well and really simply, so anyone else can understand it. And so I just think sometimes we're trying to do step three or four, and we haven't taken step one and two yet.
Okay. Anything else? Just a comment. As you were thinking, I personally think we should.
I'm totally confused.
Try to expand the, the reach of the consultants to include those things you've just talked about, not just the transit center, but downtown parking and all those, because it's all one system.
Yes. And it has to be someone that knows transit to be able to look at the whole system and make it work. Yeah. And it should work for the residents who are having their spots in front of their houses taken away by people parking. It should work for the people downtown. It has to work for everybody. So.
So we're going to talk to the consultants and see what.
Good luck.
Yeah, I think I'm not going to be on the board, but I think hearing from them is a good idea.
Yeah, yeah.
I think it's an initial point of information, additional point. So.
Okay. Thank you.
I think you all do just fine. You have my full support, Jim.
Thank you. The next item is Selectmen reports and comments. First is impact of 2017 annual town meeting action on future of our island home. I put this on the agenda because I really thought this board began this year in May with a lot of analysis and made the decision to develop a new our island home at Maya Comet using the small house model. And then we, as you know, we've worked hard to accomplish that, and town meeting sent us a very different message. So kind of as we bookend the topic for the year in this board, I thought we should have just a conversation about it and see if there are some next steps anyone has. But I think it's important we have an understanding about what no means. So I'm sure we don't have any recommendations, but just wanted to open it up for discussion by this board. So who'd like to start?
I'll start. I'll comment. I have my hand up at town meeting. I didn't get called. It was too late. I have a feeling that what we witnessed at town meeting, if it continues, is the end of our island home. I think if we don't find a way to, do it quickly, it will. Yeah, I agree with Bobby. It will never pass at the ballot. And I think those are the first two steps out of the business. And I think that's unfortunate, because we had a lot of this information for a long time. And I think what happened is a lot of us understood it really well. We've read everything and we understand it. And so we made decisions based on the information that we had, which, you know, people are contesting it, but it's 95% correct. You know, when I think the building committee has another step to do. I think we should still pursue it, but I think the townspeople have to realize if we continue doing this, it will not win at the ballot and we'll be out of the business. And I feel very strongly that way. The numbers are just, it's frightening. You know, it's $2 million a year cost of living increases, $1 million a year loss of savings. I mean, it's incredible. And you know, if this takes 3 years or 5 years, we'll be going to town. We're going to be going to town to the ballot with something that's $40 million, caught losing us, you know, $5 or $6 million a year. And if anyone thinks that that's going to pass at the ballot, they're crazy. And so, you know, and I'm not doing this as a threat. I was just really disappointed that, that the conversation wasn't more positive. You know, so anyway.
It sort of reminded me a little bit of the wind turbines, and we had a lot of different folks in the town at loggerheads. And it's been, what, 5 years? There's no wind turbine of that side except at the school. And I doubt there will be one for another 5 years. And that sort of tails a little bit on Matt's comment, just to try and draw a lesson from that. I personally think that the decisions, the recommendations were really the best for the residents, first off. That's the first issue of importance. And the issues of moving it to the new site made sense in the long term. I believe personally in sort of the continuum of care idea with Sherburn Commons there. A lot of people apparently think that's, boy, really negative. I think it's really positive. And I'm disappointed. And I'd have to be honest with you, I don't think I could ever vote for the kind of cost structure, personally, at the current site. I think it's very expensive. I think the site is not the kind of place where a town should be committing resources of that magnitude. It reminds me of, you know, any site these days where you have sea level rise, climate change, impacting sites, it just doesn't make sense to make that kind of investment. So that's some advice to where you go, because I think you ought to push ahead, more work. The building committee did a great job, and do some more, but you still have the, you're on the right track. So,
Don?
You don't want to go first?
I don't want you.
I mean, I think we got a clear message with not purchasing the property at Maya Comet that no one wants us to do any further work on pursuing that. I also came away with a fairly clear message that there's a lot of people who aren't even comfortable with spending $30 million. On this facility. And I just don't know where that leaves us, because trying to create something building on site, which I personally think is somewhat of an irresponsible path, it's going to be more costly. No matter how you slice it, even if it was the same cost, it's going to take too many years and too many rising costs to get there. So I think that we should reconvene the building committee, figure out everything possibly we can do to improve that building to make it the most comfortable possible for the residents. And if small additions can be done or systems can be upgraded, what all of the options are to keep that facility running for as long as possible. And I think we should do a lot of work into providing further home health care options on this island. That's kind of where I am right now, and obviously get more input from the community.
Well, I guess one, oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Jim.
No, go ahead.
So I picked up the paper this morning, and the first thing I saw was that the town of Framingham is now the city of Framingham. It was very interesting, because what I witnessed on Saturday, in my mind, was the most obvious and blatant evidence that town meeting form of government is broken in Nantucket. 500 people at the peak, maybe 600. Catherine, what was the total count? 562 out of... And we have, what, 9,000 voters? We do. 562 people came to town meeting and made a decision for 9,000 voters. Framingham has, I think, 10,000 or something like that. And They have a representative form of town meeting where 216 individuals from 18 precincts go to town meeting and vote, and they've now decided to have a mayor and a city council. Whatever. We're not there. We're probably not going to be there in my lifetime, but I feel like I have a pretty good pulse on the people that don't go to town meeting but do go to the ballot and vote. And it has been a very difficult sell for me to get them to pony up for $30 million for a new island home. It's going to be an impossible sell to get them to pony up to $40 million or $45 million or whatever it is. That being said, the voters have spoken, so the building committee needs to resume, and we need to look at either moving the landmark house or dwindling down the residents to 20 and then going from there. Neither of these paths is going to happen in the next 24 months, in my mind. Maybe they can, but I don't see who's going to drive that bus. I don't see this board doing it. You know, you're going to tell the building committee to go down the road, and maybe by next town meeting they'll have a recommendation for the cost to move the landmark house and displace those people and build a new facility up front. I don't know. I don't know where you go with this. I mean, we have a lot of things on the plate, and obviously this isn't one of them that's, there's a lot of decisiveness in the town. I mean, it was pretty evident in town meeting. So I don't know where you go from here. But I really think it's an unfortunate situation that 400 people decided the fate of 9,000, because I don't think that 400 people truly represented what the voting masses of Nantucket feel about the island home. And I say that because I talk to a lot of those people that don't ever come to town meeting, will never come to town meeting, but they do go to the ballot and vote.
So I guess my just a couple comments. I would ask, first of all, the building committee was charged by this board to develop a new island home at Sherburn, at my comment, Sherburn Commons. So that's their charge. And what we should think about today is should that be changed, or should we think about changing it? Personally, I mean, the options of building on that site, we know for a minimum it's a 30% construction premium to do that. That's $9 million. And we know of all the disruption. So I personally, and that's obviously within this board or next board can debate that, but I don't see that as viable. And you've heard me talk about, we have some, major concerns, major issues now in terms of the repairs of that building, but we've also got some quality issues that are building related that we have to deal with. So
the existing building wasn't to code the day we built it.
Right.
We had to ask for waivers on the room sizes. The beds were up against the wall from day one. And so, we've had waivers right from day one. And we were getting letters in the 70s, right? Early 80s. So that's been, hanging over our head almost from the beginning. And so I don't,
Good luck.
Thank you.
Don's suggestion isn't a bad one, to say, to have the bill, instead of have the building committee dig into, is it possible at all to modify what we have?
Well, I think that's the guidance you
that's
got
the
from
only,
town
that's
meeting
the
is
guidance,
to
that's the only
how do we
do.
Keep the facility that we have in maintenance and up to snuff and open as long as possible? Because right now, there's no other alternative other than you have two options. You move the landmark house and build a new one up there, or you dwindle the amount of residents down to 20 and tear down half the building and go down that road. I mean, there was a time when we had to do some work on the roof. I was talking with the assistant town manager about this just the other day, and it was like a week's worth of work, and all we got was grief from the residents and the staff about the noise. So think about that for a year, what it's going to be like. So, I don't know. I mean, I think you need to just say to the building committee at this point, okay, give us alternatives and options of what we can do on this facility, on this location, because land's gone.
We may be able to solve some things like a new, like more storage. Maybe we can create some more private rooms.
Maybe take the numbers down to 30 instead of 40.
Maybe there could be more assisted living options created on the island.
It doesn't do anything about the long-term problem, though. Right. One of the things that the committee said was we need to have a study to see if we need 40 or 50 or 60 beds. Do you want to go down that road? Do you want to do the study? Because
no, we can't. There's a moratorium. We're not going to get more than 45.
Right. And so,
but I, when I go in and visit people and I see people lying in a twin bed, curtain, they're not by the window, they're lying, in a fetal position, their body up against the concrete wall or whatever it is, and we have to change that. So, excuse me. Well,
Can I just say one other thing? I think we've talked about a message from town meeting, but we all need to remember town meeting was roughly 50-50. I think town meetings get emotional, and people respond to emotion, and that's a lot of what this was about at the time, not rational decision making. And I think maybe over time people will realize that. And I'm hoping there's an opportunity to come back with the right solution, Jim. Because the same folks, the other 50%, can have the same reaction. I could see somebody deciding to put together a citizen article. Say, gee, I'd like the town to spend $50 million, $40 million, you pick the number, and rebuild this site in two stories or whatever. And I think if you go to town meeting with that, you're going to have the same kind of result. A lot of people are going to say, no, thank you. That's the wrong place to do that kind of thing. It is too much money. So this idea that we received a message that was clear is right.
No,
so.
We didn't.
Well, we received a message clear that they don't want it at Sherbourne Commons. So
well, I don't think we did. 50% of the people were willing to say, yes, Bobby, then the message might have. You could rephrase it the other way.
I think we received the message clear when we didn't purchase the land.
But I think that's clearly related to the first vote in the motion. People got up and said, oh, you lost that vote.
I think
take it off the table.
It's clear we don't want to spend money on anything.
Well, that's a different question.
If the choice was we're going out of the business or we're moving it to Sherbourne Commons, we might have got a different vote.
That's right. Let's be honest about it.
And I don't think we explained it particularly well myself. I don't think that, I think that we, sometimes when you're too close to it, you don't, you take it for granted that everyone else knows what you know. Well, and I don't think I don't think we did a great job of, and no offense to any of us that spoke.
But we were cautious about not being threatening.
I think we all had that feeling in mind, but we felt
we
be absolutely pillared if we threatened with
we
that.
Have a facility now. We had a fine from the state, yes, we fixed that problem. It's not closed down, the roof's not leaking, water's not falling through. We do everything we can to keep it as good a facility as we can and keep it up to speed, and I guess we look at how we can build on that location and move on from there,
Did we ever hear back from the state? Sorry.
We did, actually. He spoke to Libby and I the day before the town meeting. I wasn't going to, because it was a telephone conversation. It wasn't so, but Libby can, because the letter, I guess I signed the letter, so he said we can't, we can't tell you can't build there until you spend all the money to develop a plan that meets DPH approvals, and we'd have to have basically construction drawings.
Did you ask him to put that in writing?
Just a minute. No, let me finish.
All right.
And then I said, what do you think of our current plan? And his kind of answer was, when your folks came up in December, I think you went to that meeting, made a presentation in December?
Rachel?
Okay. He said the plans they presented, and I didn't hear what they were, I assume my comment, were very exciting. And then I said, what about what we're hearing from FEMA and Army Corps of Engineers? Can you tell us that you won't allow it because of that? He said, well, those are certainly inputs that will be important in making our decision. So those were the... Is that square with what he told
you? So go back to town meeting in the fall and ask for $2 million to design a facility on the present location. And then if the town meeting gives you the $2 million, draw the plans and then send them to the state and have them give me a yay or nay. I mean, I guess that's the next step.
Or you ask for him to put it in writing.
He won't put it in writing until he looks at the plans.
I understand, but if he has to put in writing what he just said to Jim, you know, it's not, in my mind, it's not probably a coincidence. It's a phone call. Put in writing that you won't do it, and then we can go back and embarrass him.
I don't think
say,
they're going to
give it. Well, Bobby, you can say you don't think.
They told us that in November and December when they were up there. They couldn't, we're going to put it in writing.
I think you're going to have to spend the money to get a yes or a no.
I think it's embarrassing that the state that they care that little. And they should be embarrassed that they care that little about $2 million worth of taxpayer money. I mean, that is absolutely crazy. Yeah. You know, if there's a couple, I understand, it's bureaucracy, and bureaucracy is dumb. But I just don't, you know, I think we should shine a light on that. If that's how they're going to act, I just don't agree with it. I think what they're doing is irresponsible. And it's not helping the residents, and it's not helping the taxpayers.
It's either this board sponsors the article or a citizen sponsors the article, but... If you're going to find out once and for all, that's the only way to do it, is to come up with the money, design something, and send it to the state.
You know, it surprised me that no one tried to make an amendment at town meeting.
To say,
we'll appropriate the money, but we only want you to look at the East Creek site. Nobody did.
I think that was
surprising
but that
to
wasn't,
me.
I mean, no, it was the article was for my comment, so that was what was. There was no affirmative vote for anything, like you said.
Well, I think that I was surprised that someone didn't try to amend
it.
Okay. Well, Libby, it'll be the three of you and two new members' decision to do what you want going forward. But, I mean, it was pretty clear to me that the My Comet site is off the table. Hmm. So if the town wants to continue to be in the island home business, I think you're going to have to come up with the money and draw plans for the present location in one form or another and send them to the state for approval and then go... If the state approves it, then go to town meeting, figure out what it's going to cost, and ask the voters if they want to fund it, and then go from there. And that's probably a 2 to 5 year process.
Do we need to make any kind of a motion to change sort of the charge of the building committee?
Right now their charge is to build a My Comet. I guess the question is, do we want them to spend any time planning a new facility at East Creek? My personal opinion is no. That's why we recommended My Comet. But I would like to have them focus on making the repairs that need to be done.
So we have a building committee meeting scheduled for next Tuesday at 2:00.
Yeah.
And I would suggest that after that meeting, that's a town meeting follow-up meeting and a meeting to review potential planning for repairs, maintenance, and capital improvements for the next 3 to 5 years. And I would probably suggest that we don't have a formal building committee anymore, but we engage some of the citizens with the expertise that are on that committee in a more informal manner to help us develop those plans.
But if someone would like to make a motion that we should plan a new facility at East Creek, they are welcome to make that. I wouldn't make that motion.
I'm going to let you wait till you have a full new board.
So no one wants to make that motion.
I do think that no matter what we do, we should still be comparing it. Like at some point, because if we just do it on East Creek and it gets, you know, and we don't have the comparison. Just like if we just do East Creek and don't have if we don't have a comparison of one to the other, then, you know, what if it goes down? You know, if we want to, I just think we still need to be looking at it. I might be, you know, I might be kind of crazy, but the numbers were pretty compelling to me.
Yeah, Matt, that's why I don't think we're crazy to keep looking at Maya Comet. I mean, it's the right answer, so.
We don't have the land.
We've got to work that out. I mean, you know, maybe it'll be available next time.
It took a long time to get that
I understand,
land.
Dawn, but, you know, it, that land's been there for a while. It might be there for a while
more. It might
more.
Be. We don't know that. So we'll see. Sure.
And, you know, all of our analysis showed that the My Comet site was much preferable to the East Creek, and that was the conclusion that the building committee was coming to. And that we had all those comparisons in the handout. So,
but I think Dave Fredericks has a nice way about him, and I think he's perceived as being fairly neutral in the community. And I think if he had been available, I think the discussion would have been a little bit different at town meeting. Myself, I mean, some of us get up and talk, but we're not as convincing. I think he has credibility and may have helped us in that regard. And if they do more work with the operational and some of the other aspects, and we can go back with those solved, maybe we have a shot at it.
Anything else? See some folks out here who have a strong interest in the Island Home. Any of you like to make a quick comment? No? Yes? No? Would you come to the microphone and introduce yourself?
Minnesota, one comment, because I really think that this issue did not have to be so adversarial. I think we can come together. I think we've got experts out in the community. I think you had a working group that was really trying to do a good job and came up with some information and didn't have enough time or the information to get you exactly what you wanted. But I really think that you needed to do a little bit better job, kind of using the hospital's model. You didn't have all that resource for you. But there was maybe one public hearing that we went to. Jim Kelly was there. It wasn't even a public hearing. It was more of an informational Friends of the Island Home, and we batted around some ideas. And then in there, people were pretty adamant about the fact that they really liked the location. Okay, that's number one. And I didn't see anything after that to reach out to the community to say, this is why we want to do this. This is why we want to do that. You've got to do it. The hospital did it. Whether it's through Facebook or a flyer or hold a meeting or whatever, people will come. The other thing that really I think people were concerned about was no plan for the existing property. That's waterfront property. It's worth a lot of money. I think if you had said, well, if this is just a, you know, I'm a layperson, you know, I'm a first grade teacher, so don't take too much credibility with this stuff, because I'm not like you, I don't know the real estate market. If we sell this and we take that money and we set up a trust for the Island Home, and for the years and years and years it will generate the funds to take care of the Island Home, people might have been a little bit more happy, not happy, but reticent to the idea that, okay, we have a plan for that land. We're going to sell that land to a private person, make a lot of money, use that money to float the Island Home. Those are just two comments. And I really think at this point in time, whether you want to or not, or think it's a good idea, have some faith in that building committee, add some more consultants or experts or somebody from the healthcare field to help them and to get a good plan and bring it to the public. Do your homework in the summer, bring it to the public's attention, and we'll support you. But people just were not happy with what they were dished out. And I don't think they felt part of the process. That's just my idea.
Thank you.
Mr. Kelly, I need to make a comment on that. One of the things that we did say at one point was we would sell the property and use the money to defer the cost of a new building. We got lambasted for that. So we took that off the table. We reached out to everyone there is under the sun. The bottom line is this. There are 400 people that are really passionate about this. There are 7,000 that could care either way. I don't know how we get between the 400 that are passionate and the 7,000 that don't care. It's going to be for the next board and for all of you, quite frankly. Darcy, I've heard you talk about this. I don't think there's a person in this island that's more passionate about this than you. You're going to have to figure out a way to get to the people that don't care either way about this. This is not a school that we have to build. We have to educate our children. There's no way around that. People didn't like spending $45 million for a school, but they understood they had to spend the money. The Island Home is not a building that we have to spend the money on. And I don't want to get into back and forth with you because I'm going to be out of here. But I'm just saying, we went to this meeting. There was so much different information going back and forth. I knew this was going to happen. The building committee, the committee that was formed last year at town meeting wanted to put this off to fall town meeting. I don't think it would have made a bit of difference. I mean, we're at a point, we're at an impasse. And I don't know how we move forward at this point. Nobody wants it out to the
Sherburn Commons property. There's all this concern that we're going to privatize it and we're going to charge $5,000 a person so that nobody in Nantucket can afford it. There's so much different information out there. You know, I thought when I first looked at this and we looked at this 3 years ago, it was, okay, what's the best model? What's the best a building to take care of our elderly for the next 50 years? The small house model came up. We met with the consultants. They explained it to us. If I was older and I was had to move into one of these facilities, this is what I would want. I would want my own room with privacy and dignity. We talked about, okay, we have this piece of land. We can sell it for a substantial amount of money and help defer the cost of the new building. That was taken off the table right away. Oh, you just want to develop the land on the harbor front. I mean, I heard so many different things from, one of the comments was, we'll just buy the lumberyard and use that land to expand the existing facility. The lumberyard land isn't even for sale, and by the way, we don't have the money to buy the lumberyard if it was. I heard, Timmy, you said to me, we'll put him in the hospital for a year until we build a new facility. That's not on the table either. I mean, there's so many things out there that people are throwing ideas left and right. I don't know how you get to a point where you all are on the same page and we get the voters on the same page. This is probably the most complex thing that I have seen the town deal with in 25 years. And I don't know where we go from here. All I know is we have a facility that is getting worse and worse every year. And my biggest concern is that 3 or 4 or 5 years from now, the state walks in and says, I'm sorry, you can't take any more new residents in the facility. And then we go into panic mode, and then it's too late. Because if that happened today, it would take us 2 years to build a new facility. We'd have to find a piece of land. We'd have to get plans. We'd have to get approvals. We'd have to go out to bid. And before we do any of that, we have to have an appropriation in place. Because you all, Timmy, you know this as well as I do. It drives me crazy. Unlike the private sector, you can't build anything until the money's in place. So you have to figure out where it's going to be you're going to build, where it's going to be, and try to come up with a number of what you think it's going to cost, and then you go out to build, to bid. And we've learned anything from the fire station. We started at 15, we went to 17. We're probably going to be at 21 or 22 by the time we actually get around to building it. We've gone to town meeting 3 times. If that happens with an island home that the state has said you can't take any new residents in, by the time we build it, there'll be no residents left. And I'm very, very concerned that we will be out of this business in 5 years. And I think that's an absolute shame because we have taken care of our elderly on this island forever. And I dread the day when that happens. So I think you all in this audience need to figure out a way to get to it because I'm not going to be here. And I don't think this board really wants to deal with it anymore, quite frankly.
Thank you, Bobby. Oh, yes.
Well, Timmy's going up. The one thing I will say is the town has done as much work or more work on this and had a lot of good work done than just about anything that I've seen. And I could be critical at times, but this, you know, maybe that was part of the problem is that we were we're too close to some of it because we did a lot of work on it.
Tim?
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I wish I didn't have to get up here and say anything, but I need to say a few words in response to a lot of what's been said here tonight. 4 of you, with the chairman excluded, knew exactly what the outcome of this town meeting was going to be. As a matter of fact, you all voted to support the recommendations of the work group and delay this so we could continue. We got a vote from you to take it off the warrant. So don't say we're going to be out of the business. You all agreed with the recommendations of the work group, not the building committee. A week later, things changed. And I'm sure Mr. Kelly had a lot to do with that. But you agreed, all of 4 of you that were here that night agreed with the work group that we needed more time to build consensus to get the community to support the island home. And frankly, this work group that I had the privilege to work on since December did a lot of work, and you didn't like what we were saying. That's why you created a building committee. Nobody in this community wants a new island home or an upgraded island home more than the work group. We are not against the island home. We're for it. We need you to support the work group to build a consensus in the community so that we can build what everybody wants, not what the five of you want. So I'd be careful what you're saying, threatening the community, we're going to be out of the business. No, we aren't. No, we aren't. We've got a long history of taking care of our elders. And just like John O'Connor said, it's not 40 people or 45. It may be 40 today and another 40 tomorrow and another 40 next year. And maybe at some point we'll be there. We'll be the 40. But I ask you, you didn't mention the work group here once tonight. It was the building committee and talking amongst yourselves. Include the work group. Include the voices that are contrary to what you want to hear. And maybe that's how you put a consensus together to do this right. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. All right. We're going to move on. Oh, did you have, no?
Well, I was just going to say, you know, we did, from the time that the work group report came out, and I am the one who sat through almost all of the work group meetings and all of the building committee meetings and numerous other meetings, and we did a tremendous amount of work after the vote was made to put it on this warrant, trying to answer all of the questions and do so much outreach. I mean, I spoke in a number of different forums that were open to the public, and Jim did even more than I did, trying to get the word out there, answer everybody's questions. The building committee tried to answer everybody's questions, and I don't feel anymore like the result would have been different in October. And it's really hard because we put so much work on this, and it's really important. And I do care a tremendous amount about what happens here. It was the first thing that I wanted to do when I took office. I went and visited the island home and started trying to work on this. But I don't know where we move from here. I don't think it's going to be the responsible thing to propose a probably 50 plus million dollar super disruptive construction project on the current site. I don't find it to be a viable option. I wish that were different, but no one has really shown me a proposal that works, and we'll reconvene discussion on it.
Darcy, I just ask you to not, if somebody's already said something, we just new information, new comments.
Darcy Creech, and I would just like to say, I think the writing for the, you know, you're trying to build consensus, but the writing has been on the wall for over a year and a half when everybody got wind that you had already decided. Every headline in the paper was the Board of Selectmen has decided. The community has never felt like they had any decision, and frankly, that's why you didn't get more votes, because nobody thought they had to show up, because you convinced everybody that the decision had already been made. And I think, you know, a year and a half ago when we started meeting at the VFW, and there were a petition of 500 people who felt very strongly about keeping Island Home where it was, it's a tradition. It's something that people feel extremely proud about, taking care of our elderly. I mean, the rest of the community is going to be bequeathed the Odison property in not too long of a time. What is wrong with keeping the sliver for the elderly? It's a place where we can make it an attractive magnet for the whole community. It can enrich the elderly people's lives. They're isolated. You know, to have families and young kids coming there would only help them and combat depression and isolation and everything else. And I don't feel like the people who have been hired, the architect will say that he was hired to focus on making Sherburn Commons work. Island Home was never given serious consideration. And it's super obvious to those of us who are not proponents of Maya Comet. I get the whole idea about continuing care. My mom's in a continuing care facility. There's a lot of great things about it. My big question is, if the town is so into continuing care retirement community, why didn't they buy Sherburn Commons for $5 million? Why did somebody who happens to be a member of the finance committee orchestrate that purchase? The story doesn't add up.
You want to know why, Darcy? So, because the town can't afford to be in the Island Home into the business.
Darcy. Okay, but you need to say that to the community.
Excuse me, Darcy.
You need to lay out that plan to the community.
I'm going to ask you to stop speaking.
That's because I'm.
No,
you need to lay out.
Excuse me.
No, you need to lay out the community. We can stay. We can privatize it, or we can spend $50 million and have it municipally run.
Darcy,
you got to be honest with the community.
I would ask you to sit down now. Thank you. Okay, moving on. Next item is report on town manager performance evaluation. On an annual basis, this board reviews the performance of the town manager. And as part of that due diligence, board members fill out individual performance evaluations for the town manager. And then a summary is created by the chairman of the board. I read it tonight, and then it'll be made public. So I'm just going to read the summary report of the annual town manager evaluation. So this is summary town manager performance evaluation, April 2016 to March 2017. The following is the summary of the individual performance evaluations completed by the five members of the Board of Selectmen. The survey instrument measures performance in nine areas. They include interaction with the Board of Selectmen, budgetary financial administration, personnel administration, supervision and leadership, staff development, public relations, employee and labor relations, effectiveness and productivity, and personal qualities. Each of the performance standards and accomplishments are measured using the following scale. 5, consistently exceeds expectations. 4, exceeds expectations. 3, meets expectations. 2, needs improvement. 1, unsatisfactory or no action has been taken in this category. The average mean score for all selectmen from this instrument is 3.8. The midpoint median is 4.0. The categories of performance standards and accomplishments with the highest ratings are public relations, personnel administration, staff development, and personal qualities. The category with the greatest opportunity for improvement is employee and labor relations, and signed by me as chairman. I would ask for a motion to approve this summary.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
Jim, can I make one comment?
Sure.
Not so much that the report's fine. I think it's helpful that the, as a general principle, we may want to look at this as part of the town manager evaluation policy, that contract and salary initiatives should follow the evaluation process. And just think about that, because we took action on salary and contract several months ago. At that time, we didn't have an evaluation. So I just think that's the logical sequence that this ought to be accomplished by. So you may disagree, but that's
positive. I'm trying to understand. Well, the contract negotiation for the town manager happened
for the town manager. I think
happened before. I know before I was on the board.
Well, there was a contract extension maybe before you were on the board. Maybe it was a year ago.
Yeah, I wasn't part of
that. That's all right. I think it's helpful to look at that.
So Bobby, these are supposed to be done annually. So
I understand. Okay. I'm just making a recommendation.
Are there any committee reports to come before us tonight? No?
I've just got one comment. There's I think I might have sent this to you, Jim. There's a bill going through the State House MMA about updating the room occupancy tax rules. They want comments from summer resorts, tourist places. I think it's, there was an article in your Mass Municipal that you can read, but I think at some point in the future we should consider commenting once we understand a little better.
I just have one comment. I just want to thank this board for the opportunity to serve as your chair for the last year. And I look forward to moving down to another site next week where I'm no longer chair, and look forward to having a new chair to represent the Board of Selectmen.
Is you putting in your resignation?
Thank you very much.
I think you just did.
I think the writing was on the wall there, guys. You better figure it out.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
One last time,
yes, sir.
So moved.
Okay, thank you.
Sir.
Second. All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.